Let's see, people are already tweeting. What time do we start up again? Okay. In about 1 minute.
Jim? It's Nicholas, I'm John.
Oh, I'm sorry. These are my next door neighbor, Nicholas, and Alex, my neighbors.
Hi, Alex.
And my friend, Bobby Rice.
Hi, Bobby.
Pleasure. Nice to meet
you. Bobby, another Tolkien historian and Tolkien fan. Do you know who else is surprisingly hardcore Tolkien nutcase? And, you know, we keep surprising ourselves with these little bits that come out of the woodwork. But, you know, I'm bringing Sexy back. Yes. Who? Justin Timberlake. He will quote from the Silmarillion. He will quote fucking, like, old school barbs of ancient Tolkien that only geeks like me would know. Yeah, you didn't know that, Bobby, did you?
I didn't know.
Yeah, and he won't admit it. You know, at least Vin Diesel will admit outwardly he plays D&D and he likes to geek out. Vin Diesel is an out-of-the-closet geek. I don't think Timberlake is out of his geek closet yet. Are we live? Because I really wanted that to be heard live. That's funny.
So we're gonna clear this out when the show starts. So Cliff, you ready?
I'm quite ready. Are you guys, John?
Or should I look at you, right?
If you want.
Try to be natural.
If you want to just say hey, you know.
Like guys.
We need to rotate that camera a few degrees towards John.
I'm ready.
That's great.
Have my nose in the picture. That'd
you know, if we had the Charlie Rose table, we could totally talk across to each other. But
you have to talk really slow, though, right?
Yes.
The Charlie
Rose. And deep and resonantly. He's got that voice, that Charlie Rose voice. Yeah, we're ready. But most of the time when I'm talking to them, you know, and usually I'm trying to look at the monitor. Do you have an iPad set up so we can see the comments in the room?
Yeah, we'll get that in a sec.
That's fantastic. Thanks.
All right, you're live.
We are live. Well, hello, everybody. Again, another live edition of Torn Tuesday starts, 1 minute late when we're usually, you know, 14 or 17 minutes late. And this is an important day, ladies and gentlemen. We are actually live on time. Much to my surprise. So check this out, guys. We have a very excellent show lined up for you. Welcome to TheOneRing.net, which is, of course you know, the centerpiece of the Tolkien community online. It's a big web community. You can join us at the live chat room at TheOneRing.net/live. You can also be part of our show at our host StickCam, because we've got a big account where you can video Skype in to be part of the show that way. And that's at StickCam.com/TheOneRing. So now that station identification is out of the way, I'd really be sad if you guys missed this show today. We've got an announcement from Peter Jackson that there's a third Hobbit film. Warner Brothers is on board. There's millions of dollars being shifted around. The marketing department at Warner Brothers is going crazy. They're going to have a new name for a third film. We don't even know what it is yet. And the blogosphere is bursting at the seams with, you know, ringer excitement. And aside from all that, we have an incredibly talented, very, very wonderful animator, creator of Ren and Stimpy, and of course he's also worked with Ralph Bakshi in the not so distant past. Mr. Bakshi, who was the director of the 1978 Universal, that was actually not Universal, it was United Artists that released The Lord of the Rings in 1978, and that was the movie that inspired Peter Jackson to do what he is doing today. Believe it or not, we have John Kricfalusi, ladies and gentlemen, who has worked with so many talented people, created amazing shows, got in more than his fair share of trouble, you know, as a groundbreaking animator. I love it. I love the mischief that you have caused.
Wasn't on purpose.
Ladies and gentlemen, John Kay.
Hi.
All right, when do we start talking about the goddess, Bjork?
Talk about it right now.
I can't tell you how much I worship the goddess. I mean, you know, Bjork is Bjork, and nobody else, no other musician is in any other class like she is, seriously. What did you think when she said, let's work on this project, let's do this video?
Well, actually, I met her manager first.
Yeah?
And because I was dating a music manager in the 90s, and she introduced me to Bjork's manager, and they got me some tickets to see a Bjork show that was playing at, I forget where, somewhere in Hollywood.
Yeah?
And
your first time?
A backstage pass. Yeah, mm-hmm. It was the first time.
Okay.
I mean, I knew her from her videos and her music and stuff. So after the show, I went back. It was a great show. Mm. I went backstage, and she looked kind of tuckered out because, you know, she's pretty energetic and stuff like that. She was just sitting on this little bench in a little room. There were people milling around, and she was kind of shy. Her manager introduced me to her. Oh, here's what happened. Her manager told me that Bjork was a big Ren and Stimpy fan and that she used to watch it with her kid.
Yeah.
I guess he's grown up now. So.
All those liberal Icelanders letting their kids watch, you know, Ren and Stimpy.
So anyways, I'm sitting on the bench next to her. Her manager introduces me. This is the Ren and Stimpy guy. His name's John. And she's super shy, right? She goes, hello, like this. And, you know, I didn't really know what to say. So I had to break the ice somehow. And there were these, like, flyers for other shows just laying around on the floor and stuff. And I reached over and I picked one up and I drew a picture of Bjork dancing with my character, Jimmy the Retarded Boy.
With Jimmy, yeah.
And I signed it and to Bjork, you know, from your big fan, John Kay. I turned it around and showed it to her. And she grabbed it. She clutched it to her chest like this. And she was, like, giggling and stuff. And I said, well, you want to make a music video? And she went, okay. And that was it. The next week, we were working on it.
Really? That was
oh,
it?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
That's a hard sell.
Then she sent me a I Miss You.
Yes.
She wanted to do an animated video on. Mm-hmm. And we set up a phone call because I wanted her to, you know, tell me everything she thought that the song meant and how to get that into the end of the story and stuff. And the interesting thing was she told me what it meant, but then said, go ahead and do whatever you want because you're the director. And, you know, I just want to see what you come up with that goes with the music. So I had never had anybody give me a note like that, right? I mean, normally you send an idea to somebody and 15 executives in a room, like, just scrawl all over your story
mm-hmm.
and write 18 million mm-hmm. notes on it, and they all contradict each other, and you don't know what to do, right?
Right.
So now she's just telling me to do whatever you want.
Carte blanche. Go ahead, she said.
And that actually was sort of hard because I wasn't used to that. So I did a storyboard. I listened to the song, you know, mm-hmm. and I'd pause it line by line, and I just kind of drew it straight ahead.
Yeah.
Did a storyboard in about a week.
Yeah.
Then I sent her the storyboard, and, you know, I called her up again. Because I wanted to get her notes. I was sure she'd give me a bunch of notes
yes.
on the storyboard.
And she said?
The only thing she said was, you made me very cute. Uh-huh. I've never seen that before. And she said, go ahead and do it. And,
yeah.
And that was it. I just couldn't believe it. Just straight into it.
That's great.
Yeah.
Well, the song is so perfectly suited for eccentric visuals. I mean, it's filled with accordions and trumpets and all these interesting things. It's like her arrangements are so wacky and so interesting. It must have been a field day for you.
Oh, yeah. I mean, I had too many ideas. Each little yeah. musical phrase would give me 15 visual ideas. It was like...
Yeah?
But I wanted to get it done fast, so...
Yeah, and it took how long to produce?
It took pretty long to produce. It was like 8 months or something like
wow.
that.
Wow.
Because it was multimedia, right?
Yeah.
We did some full animation. We did some live action. We did some early CG. It was actually me dancing with Bjork.
That
the
was
CG
you?
Sequences,
yeah.
but I was wearing the little balls all over me and the motion yeah. capture stuff. I was playing Jimmy the Idiot Boy.
You were, yeah, I saw that.
And I don't know, the CG was kind of clunky, but I just wanted to try it, see how it would work.
That was a Gollum 1.0 motion capture, probably.
The kind of pretty primitive version
yeah,
of it.
Yeah, very super. That's so cool, though. So I have to say, that's really exciting. I mean, I would have loved to have been in the same room to see her react like that. But the video, the results are fantastic, and it stands the test of time. A lot of your animation really is unique among American design animation. It is so, it's so eccentric and so ballsy. Sometimes you've taken risks with content and gotten into some notorious strips of trouble in a good way. I mean, you've done some really groundbreaking stuff, and this is going to lead me up to the Ralph Bakshi conversation. Many of us around here, especially me, are big fans of Ralph Bakshi. And tell me about when you first met him and when you first started working with him.
The first time I met him was about 1979. And I'm from Canada, and I was going to Sheridan College studying animation.
Yeah.
Well, I was supposed to be studying. But anyways, I came down for the Christmas break, and I went on a studio tour to go and bring my portfolio around and see if I could get a job.
Uh-huh.
And one of the studios that I set up an appointment was Bakshi Studio, and this was when he was on Sunset Boulevard.
Yeah.
In one of the towers. So I went up there, and they had me just sitting in the reception waiting for him, and he was working on Lord of the Rings, I think, at that time.
Yeah.
And I could, I was just sitting waiting, but I could hear somebody bellowing, screaming at the top of their lungs, just somewhere, going all through the cubicles and stuff like that. It's the loudest voice I ever heard in my life.
That sounds like him.
Huge, booming voice, like a god or something, right? It's like Thor or something like that, with a Brooklyn accent. So finally, this monster comes out. This guy's like 6'4" or something like that, and he looks like Paul Bunyan. He, at the time, he had this big, heavy black beard, really thick, and he had black, curly hair, and he's just like huge shoulders, fists this size. And after, like, I heard him yelling at everybody, right? So I thought he was going to come out and kill me or something. Instead, he comes out, giant smile on his face, and he grabs my hand. How you doing there, kid? It's like crushing all the knuckles in it. How you doing there? Slapping me on the back. I fly about 15 feet. You know, and he grabs my portfolio. I could tell he was real busy, but I'm not even sure why he bothered to see me. He didn't know who I was or anything. I was just some punk, you know, out of, going to school or something. But he rips my portfolio open. He looked at a bunch of the drawings. He's flying them around and stuff like that.
Yeah.
And they're all wacky drawings, right? They don't go with Lord of the Rings, what he was doing. He was doing rotoscoping and stuff.
Yeah.
All realistic stuff. But he was laughing. So this fucking funny shit you got here, kid. You know, come back when I do some funny shit. This is great. Come back in 2 weeks.
And then really?
Okay. Slaps me one more time, and he runs back into the cubicles. He disappears, and I just hear screaming and stuff, and people running out crying and things. And that was my first encounter with Ralph Bakshi.
His Brooklyn accent is unmistakable. He's so funny. He's very funny.
He's hugely funny.
Yes, and he's and he's always known for being rough around the edges. I mean, he's just legendary. That's just insane. At the time, we didn't know exactly what Lord of the Rings would look like. I mean, I was just a kid. He was working on it, and I was 10 or 11 years old when that was released, and it was my first time actually looking at this wonderful world, which is one of our favorite books ever, and he had done this interesting wobbly, squiggly rotoscoping. He had Billy Barty, live action footage of Billy Barty, who we've seen in
Was he Frodo?
Yeah, he was. He was Bilbo.
he
was Bilbo, and I'm sure, and you know, we've seen him in Time Bandits, and he's been, you know, inside the R2-D2.
Billy Barty's hilarious.
He's the best.
You ever see the Spike Jonze show?
Oh, God, that's funny.
The 50s?
Yeah,
Billy Barty's all through that.
Yeah, he's
great.
Funny. Yeah. I love that stuff. And then he's taking this great photography, and he's animating over it. And what did you think of it when you saw this? This first time you saw The Lord of the Rings, with the weird kaleidoscope lights in the backgrounds behind Gandalf and Saruman. And it was really psychedelic, wasn't it?
You know, it was so long ago. I don't remember the psychedelic part. I remember characters running and tripping and falling every 2 seconds.
Yeah, there was a lot of that.
You know, like, honestly, I'm not really a realistic animation fan.
Mm-hmm.
And to tell you the truth, I don't think Ralph really is either. I think he really did want to do it in live action.
Yeah.
And he actually likes cartoony animation, but he went through that rotoscope period.
He sure did.
You know, he took me aside quite a few times later and said, you know, fuck that rotoscope crap. I just had to get the stuff out, you know?
He did.
It's just I think it's a cheaper way to do animation.
He was working with Frazetta for a time, doing the Fire and Ice movie as well.
That was the second time I met him.
So, he made this big move from these motion pictures and this groundbreaking stuff he was doing, Fritz the Cat, and I really loved American Pop. I thought that was kind of cool. And then he goes into television, and he takes you along with him. Tell me how that happened.
Well, actually, I went to work for him for about a month in 1981, I think. I'd just been laid off from Filmation. At that time, almost all the work in town was Saturday morning cartoons, right? Mm-hmm. And they were seasonal. So you'd work like mad all through the summer, and then the season would start in September, and there'd be no work left until the next year.
Right.
So I just finished a stint doing, I think it was Mighty Mouse. It was the Filmation Mighty Mouse, not the Bakshi one.
Oh, okay.
Filmation was horrible beyond belief.
Yeah, yeah.
So I'm dying for work, right? I didn't want to do rotoscoping or anything like that, but I saw in the LA Weekly, I think there was an article on Ralph, and it said he was looking for some young cartoonists, funny cartoonists, to bring back animated shorts to the movie theaters.
Mm-hmm.
You know, like Bugs Bunny, that they used to run the shorts before the main feature. So I called the office, asked for Ralph. I couldn't get Ralph on the phone, but I got his secretary, and she said, well, bring your portfolio down and drop it off, and Mr. Bakshi will look at it. And she kept calling him Mr. Bakshi. You know, the way I remembered Ralph was like, it's not Mr. Bakshi, he's Ralph.
Uh-huh.
He's this big, huck, you know, lovable bear guy that you're kind of scared of, but, you know, doesn't seem like somebody you would call Mr. Anyways, so I took my portfolio down there. I left it, and a couple days later, she called back again. The receptionist called back. It was so funny because the receptionist was the opposite of Ralph. Right? She's very prim and proper, polite, good grammar, perfect English. Right? Mr. Bakshi found your work superlative. I said, does Ralph even know that, what that means? He didn't say that.
He would never talk like that.
Yeah, he probably says, fucking great.
Probably, yeah.
Get the fathole down here. That's probably more like it. But she said, oh, no, it's superlative, it's superlative.
That's
so funny. He'd like to hold an audience with you.
Mm-hmm.
Some kind of weird thing. All right, so I went down the next day, and he was in Sunland, I think, at that time. Sun Valley, Sunland, had a big, kind of a big studio, and they were finishing up. Was American Pop before Fire and Ice?
No, Fire and Ice was before American
Pop. Okay, then they were finishing up.
Yeah.
Fire and Ice.
Yeah.
And I came in, Lynn Bettner, that was his secretary, or she might have been like a producer or something too. I'm telling you, I'm not sure. She was very nice though, and she brought me in. She sat me down. Oh. I see this open door. Uh-huh. I hear yelling and spitting. Right? And I go into the office. But before I actually get in there and see Ralph, I just see these seeds flying past the open doorway. Seeds flying everywhere, right? So I go into the room with Lynn Bettner. And there was another woman there, Louise Zingarelli, who was Ralph's designer on some of the features.
Yeah.
And both Lynn and Louise were sitting there prim and proper with clipboards and everything ready to take notes from the meeting. And here's Ralph. He was a lot bigger than he was when I first met him.
Uh-huh.
Yeah. You know. And he was just sitting down like this. He was unshaven and unkempt. And he had a giant, what do you call that? It's a bag. It was a giant bag, but it's the woven kind of bag.
Uh-huh.
What do you call that?
A duffel bag?
No. It's like we keep rice in or something.
Oh,
like
okay. One of those.
I forget what the material's called.
Yeah.
Anyways, it's filled with sunflower seeds.
Yeah.
And Ralph, with his giant mitts, is digging into the thing and shoving like 100 seeds into his mouth at the same time. Chewing, and there were seeds all over his face and stuff, too. Right? He'd chew them up and then spit them all over the place. And the two girls are like, you know, trying to pretend and nothing weird's going on. So I'm sitting there watching this, and the sunflower seeds are bouncing off my head and everything. I'm just ignoring it, pretending like it's normal. You know, the boss can spit on you, whatever. And Ralph's talking to me the whole time, right? Kid, you think you're pretty fucking funny, right? And he takes my portfolio, he throws it open. Yeah, I guess it's some funny shit, right? Where the hell do you do this kind of stuff? Nobody will let you do this. I said, no, they won't let me do it, Ralph. Everybody tones down everything that I do. He says, I'll fucking let you do it. But first, oh, and then he tells me that he's going to bring back shorts to the movie theaters.
Cool.
You ever hear of Bug Bunny? Popeye? Yeah. I think so, Ralph. I kind of remember them. Great. I want to bring that kind of shit back. Fuck this feature stuff. And I made one. I made one so far.
That's Ralph.
So he had made a short.
Yeah.
And he wanted me to see it and review it.
Really?
I'm just some punk kid, you know, who's only been in the business for a year or something.
Uh-huh.
Ralph tells the two girls, take Johnny down here. And I don't think he called me Johnny yet. It took him a few years to remember my name. I think he called me Belushi or something. Or maybe it was Asshole. So he says, take him down to the Moviola. Show him the figurette in the weed. And then he looks at me, the giant finger with seeds all over it.
Yeah.
Listen, Buster. When you come back, I want you to tell me exactly what the fuck you think about it, too. I'm surrounded by yes men here. They won't tell me nothing. All right. So the girls take me down this long hallway, right, to the back of the building, into a dark room. And I think it was Peter Aries, who I later worked with, is the editor, and he's got the Moviola there, right?
Uh-huh.
And he's running stuff through the Moviola from Fire and Ice. And so the girls tell him, can you put on the cigarette and the weed to show John? So they put it on. It's only like a minute long. It was the longest minute of my life.
Really?
It was like, I couldn't even tell what was going on. There was a weed on a street corner, downtown New York, of course, you know, garbage cans around, stuff like in all of Ralph's features.
Like a street fighter, yeah.
And street fight. A cigarette butt rolls down and starts talking to the weed, and it falls off at the end and into a puddle and burns out.
A cigarette butt and...
You know, like, I was expecting some kind of new duck or rabbit or chicken cartoon or something, you know, because it said Bugs Bunny, or maybe even something like Popeye, but a cigarette and a weed. So I watch this thing, and I'm trying to think, oh, no, what can I say about this? I'm going back there.
That's too funny.
To the biggest, strongest, you know, guy in animation. I can't tell him what I thought of this. So the girls, you know, they're ready to take the notes. Okay, John, let's go back and see Mr. Bakshi. So, oh, no, no, no. In that hallway that I came down, going back, it was 10 times longer.
Really?
And I just saw the doorway, you know, at the end of this 2-mile hallway. And I just see in the distance, bing,
the seats, oh, the seats popping out the door. There,
right? So they bring me into the room, right? I'm my head is low like this. Oh, no, oh, no. This is my last day on Earth. He's going to kill me. So they sit me down, like right next to Ralph, like, you know, sit down right here, like, Ralph's got he's got the seeds and everything. Well, what do you think, asshole? Come on, tell me the fucking truth, right?
Really?
Okay, kid. And I'm like, and the girls are there looking so serious, waiting to take some constructive criticism from me, right? And I said, Ralph, that's the worst thing I've ever seen. And he went, and he spit out like 400 seeds, and then he knocked the bag over, more seeds went flying. What the fuck? The worst fucking thing you ever seen? What the fuck? And he flings the door open, and he stands up, and he starts screaming down the hallway. Finally, somebody wasn't a fucking yes man sitting in here. He tells me the goddamn truth. And then he looks at me and goes, I'm gonna kill you, kid. I'm gonna fucking kill you.
Really?
But you're not a yes man. And he turns to the girls and he says, hire this son of a bitch. I'm gonna fucking teach him a lesson. So the next day I was working there. The next day I'm working for Ralph.
That was your interview.
That was the interview, yeah.
That is crazy.
It was
you deserve some water, John. Oh my God, that was great. That's so funny.
Got any seeds for me to chew on?
And I can totally see the insanity. But artists who get to that stage of their art, if they lose a few gears with reality, that's okay. That's totally acceptable. We understand that from our artists, don't we? You know, that a few screws sometimes go a little loose sometimes.
Yeah, pretty much. Mm-hmm. The most talented ones are usually...
Yeah.
You know, kind of out there.
Okay, so let's talk about what you're doing brand new, Cans Without Labels. This is something that you're getting started with a Kickstarter page, right?
Yeah.
I mean, I just checked it out, and I thought it was really, really funny. You have these really great clips of how you can use the camera to come in and out over the scene, you know, with that the rendering of that table in the kitchen. But your story, the story about your father and those mystery cans, is hysterical. You guys, we wanted to have John come on the show today. Not only did he work with our favorite Lord of the Rings animation director, Ralph Bakshi, but John, who is, you know, the coolest guy who created Ren and Stimpy, that's something you guys grew up with and you know and love. Every time you pick a real long, hairy booger out of your nose, you remember the first time. As a kid, you saw that on Ren and Stimpy, and this is the man to blame for that lovely inspiration. Absolutely. So, John, while you're here, and we've got this audience, tell us, what's the deal with Cans Without Labels?
Well, it stars a character from Ren and Stimpy, George Licker.
George Licker,
American!
Is back.
Yeah, he's the most American human left on the planet, and the guy's kind of like he's a throwback. He's what Republicans used to be in the 50s and 60s.
Uh-huh.
Right? He thinks today's Republicans are complete wimps and stuff.
Inspired by your dad?
Well, yeah, my dad's is Canadian, right? I'm Canadian. So we don't really have Republicans or Democrats. Although we have something that's sort of like that. We have progressive conservatives. It's kind of an oxymoron. And we have liberals. But taking the politics out of it, the type of guy that George Licker is very similar to my father. You know, he's from the great generation, the greatest generation, right? He was in the big one. He was in the big war between Canada and the United States in 1978. The beer wars, the ones where the president of America wanted to steal the vast reservoirs of beer that are in Canada, because it's much more kick-ass than the wimpy American beer. Right. So when that war ended, and they announced the armistice, George Licker, you know, he was on the battlefield. He was in a trench, and he comes crawling out of the trench. He's been shooting at a Canadian right across the border, right, from his trench, and they're both bleeding all over the place. They've both taken about 40 bullets, right? But they're not dead. These are real men from both nations. So they crawl across. They hear that the armistice is enough, and they shake hands at home. Look, you may be a dirty commie, he tells the Canadian,
yeah,
but you can sure take a bullet. God damn it. And the commie that he shakes hands with is actually my dad, who appears in some of the cartoons. So George Licker is like an American version of my dad. He's very strict. He believes in discipline. Mm-hmm. It's discipline that begets love. I don't know if you remember, but there's a cartoon called Man's Best Friend that shows the origin of Ren and Stimpy and how George Licker bought them in a pet store, took them home, and taught them discipline.
Yeah, I totally remember that, the original.
Well, my dad completely believed in discipline, right? There was a rule for everything when I was a kid. When we ate, when we had dinner, like all the knives and forks and everything had to be in the perfect order, and you couldn't hold the knife in your left hand, and you couldn't hold the fork upside down, and there was a salad fork, and there was a dinner fork, and then there was like the pudding spoon, and you're like, ah! You can't remember any of this crap.
No plastic allowed either, I'm sure.
So I get my knuckles wrapped all the time because I couldn't remember the rules. Right? So there are a million rules enough. My dad used to tell me all the time, it's rules that make the world go around. And you tell that to your goddamn hippie buddies. Get a haircut.
There's a question in the chat. Did your dad play a role in becoming an animator?
No, he didn't want me to become a cartoonist. He thought that was wimpy. He wanted me to, like, you
really?
Go out and play baseball and football and hockey and everything, and I really wasn't that interested in any of that stuff. All I wanted to do was draw cartoons all day long and watch cartoons, and when I went outside to play, it was like to be bad, to smoke cigarettes and, you know, steal comic books from the local store and stuff. So he thought there was something wrong with me when I was a kid. You know, I think he thought I was gay. In fact, I know he did, because one day I came home from school, and you know, I put my briefcase down. I was really nerdy when I was a little kid. When everyone else was dressing like the Beatles in 1965, everybody was mod, 66, 65, I was wearing a suit with a bow tie and a fedora and singing Frank Sinatra songs to the girls at school. And I had a briefcase. It wasn't a real briefcase, it was a toy. It was the Secret Sam kit, which was a super spy kit that you opened up, and it had like this all these guns that you could put together, and hand grenades and nuclear weapons and everything.
That's cool.
But it looked like a briefcase, so it went with my madman outfit, you know, in 1966. What was I getting to near? Oh yeah, so I come home from school one day, put the briefcase down, I go up to my room, and I go to open my closet where I've hidden my giant stash of Marvel comics, under socks and underwear and stuff like that. And I go to grab the comics, and I look up, and on my top shelf in the closet, there's all these really fat magazines, right? Really recognizable shape of a magazine. I'm like, what the hell's going on? I look up there, and I take one down. It's a Playboy magazine. And I don't know where it came from, right? And I take the other ones down. There's like 10 Playboy magazines in my closet. And I can't figure out what's going on. Where the hell did these come from?
You didn't put them there.
No, I didn't put them there. Because I figured if I snuck in any naked magazines, my dad would kill me, right, if he caught them.
Right.
So I don't know what to do. First thing I want to do is, like, throw them out before he can catch me. But, you know, you're 11 years old, and there's Playboys in front of you. It's impossible to throw them out. So I'm terrified. For months, I'm, like, really scared, right, that something's going to – my dad's going to find the damn magazines and kill me, right? Well, I didn't know what was going on until after Ren and Stimpy, one Christmas when I was visiting home, my dad had a couple of beers in him, and he starts telling me stuff about when I was a kid. So, you know what? I was worried about you when you were a kid. I thought you were a goddamn homo. I said, what? Yeah, because you wouldn't play sports. You wouldn't play baseball. You weren't playing football or anything. You're just drawing your dumb little pictures. I thought you were some kind of fag. Right? I'm like, Jesus, Dad, you've seen me with lots of girls. And he goes, yeah, I know you're okay now. But I tell you, I was so, it was, you can thank me for that. I said, what do you mean I can thank you? Uh-huh. I put Playboy magazines in your closet. I'm like, what? I've had nightmares for, 30 years over this thing. reoccurring nightmares, thinking that someone's going to kill me if they find my Playboy magazines. I put them in there. That's why you're straight. Because you were on your way, buddy. You were on your way.
And he's taking full credit.
Oh, well, yeah.
Like, man. That's hysterical.
So yeah. did those magazines influence your earliest drawings and the earliest characters?
Well, I used to draw sexy girls all the time when I was a kid, right? Mm-hmm. Oh, I remember, this is embarrassing, but I guess this is the kind of show you're supposed to be embarrassed on. But I used to collect Archie comics, really, but more specifically Betty and Veronica comics.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Really,
and especially the summer fun issues, the ones where they're running around in bikinis and stuff like that.
Yeah, yeah. That was
and I would draw them all the time. But then I'd be terrified that my dad would find them, right? Because I remember one time I drew a really sexy Santa's helper, a girl in a miniskirt, a red miniskirt with white fur around and everything. Uh-huh. Big bazooms, as my dad called them. And I put it on the front door, right? And my dad came home from work that night, and he flipped out. He, grabs it. He chases me downstairs into the basement. He flings it at my head. You goddamn dirty pervert. It's like, don't you ever let me catch you with this. So I thought, I better hide my Betty and Veronica drawings and everything. And if he ever finds these Playboys in my closet, I'm a dead man, right?
Really?
I couldn't figure out.
Really?
It was full of contradictions, right?
Yeah. I thought he would appreciate this, Betty Page style pin-up girl.
I think authority figures, I think part of growing up and getting ready to face the world is you have to have an authority figure that's full of contradictions. Because that's what you're going to find when you get in the real world, right? So you better get used to it while you're a kid. So I thank my dad for this. So I would draw all these really sexy, I guess for an 11-year-old, I probably thought they were sexy. I'm sure they were horrible drawings of Betty and Veronica, and I hid them.
Yeah.
What the hell were we talking about?
We were filling out the stories of George.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
And how your dad has influenced George.
Yeah, my dad is a lot like George Licker.
The mystery cans.
Mystery cans.
The mystery cans.
My dad was really frugal, right? He grew up in the Depression on a farm. He's Ukrainian, came from the old country when he was 3 years old. With
so that's where that name Kricfalusi comes from.
Kricfalusi.
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 I love that. Yeah. That's great.
That's what it really is.
There you go.
And
finally, now you've heard it here first. Guys, now we know how to say it. Kricfalusi.
So my grandparents were Ukrainian on my father's side. On my mother's side, they're Scottish, English. So they were very different, my parents. But, the way my dad was raised was a lot harsher than I was raised. And, I thought I was being abused and stuff like that. And, I had everything. I had an allowance. I could buy comic books. I could get cigarettes, anything I wanted, right? But every kid thinks that they've got it hard, right? So my dad would always remind me, you think you got it hard? You don't know what hard is, buddy. We used to have to scrounge for beetles to eat. And, now you listen to the goddamn Beatles. Son of a bitch. So, there are horror stories of how he was raised. And my grandfather, to me, was super nice, right? Mm. I'd go to visit my grandparents, and they had thick Ukrainian accents, and they both had thick stubble, both my grandmother and my grandfather. They'd always, as soon as you meet, the one part I didn't like about visiting them is they would kiss you for a minute and a half right on the lips and scratch half your face off with the stubble, right? And they always had smelling of garlic and stuff like that.
Oh, yeah.
Now, my grandfather was a priest. He was a Ukrainian Orthodox priest.
Oh, wow.
Orthodox priests are allowed to marry.
So.
But he raised my dad really tough. If he did something wrong, the punishment that he would get was he'd have to kneel. My grandfather would sprinkle rice on the concrete stoop in front of the house.
Uh-oh.
And make dad kneel on it for 8 hours. That doesn't sound like that much at first. But after 8 hours, you're bleeding and crying, and it's horrible.
Yeah, that's awful.
And you can't walk for a week and stuff like that.
Oh,
so,
gosh.
They raised kids hard. Back then, teachers were allowed to beat you and stuff.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, even when I was a kid, teachers could still, wrap your knuckles with a ruler and stuff like that. Now everybody's so goddamn wimpy. It's you can't even scold your kid without going to jail, right?
And having a lawsuit, yeah.
Yeah.
No scolding. Yeah.
Everybody gets sued for everything now.
Someone in the chat room saying one of their favorite episodes was Sven Hoek.
Sven Hoek. He is Ollie, you are Sven.
Is that related to anybody based on anyone?
Well, that's related to the Flintstones. There's an episode of the Flintstones, it's one of my favorites, where a Swedish rock band, I guess is what you would call it, comes to board with Fred and Wilma. So they put them in the garage, and the two main guys are Ollie and Sven. And Sven is a tall, dumb guy with blonde hair that hangs over his face. You never see his eyes or anything. And every time the little guy, Ollie, introduces themselves to anybody, like when they first introduce themselves to Wilma, Ollie says, "I am Ollie, he is Sven." And then Sven says, "I am Ollie, you are Sven." No. You are Sven, I am Ollie. Die is Ollie, you are Sven. He is Ollie, you are Sven. Me and my friends used to go to school and do that all day. We mimicked all the cartoon voices and stuff, and that was one of our favorite ones.
That's great.
So I always wanted to do a cartoon about a Swedish guy, you know?
So was Flintstones a primary inspiration?
I watched the Flintstones like 12 times a day. I'd seen every Flintstones episode a million times. And I taught myself to draw by watching Hanna-Barbera cartoons. Those were the first cartoons I remember watching all the time. It was Huckleberry Hound, Quick Draw McGraw, Yogi Bear, and the Flintstones were the main ones. They kind of went downhill after 1960, and they really went downhill by the 70s. Like, I can't stand Scooby-Doo and all that realistic crap.
Yeah.
I like the really cartoony stuff.
Wacky Races.
Oh, yeah.
No. No wacky races.
There's nothing wacky about it.
Well, you know what?
There's nothing remotely wacky about it.
And just from the nostalgic point of view of that little kid who's thinking, what diabolical little trick is going to come out of that car next if they push that button? You know, I thought it was imaginative, but I was a 4-year-old. I was being easily entertained. Right. Sorry. All right, no.
But no, when I was a See, I watched everything change in the 60s.
Yeah.
People were always asking me, like, why am I retro or whatever. And it's because I watched everything that I loved growing up, old music, old TV shows, old movies. I watched them all, right? And old music, my dad collected. He had a ton of records. So not only would I listen to the Beatles and the Rolling Stones and whoever was popular when I was a kid, I liked that stuff. But I also liked Elvis, and I also, my dad had some Frank Sinatra, and he had old country albums, and I would play all this. I liked it all, right? And I said, this is great. But as I was growing up, everything changed in the late 60s. Mm. The goddamn hippies ruined everything. The hippies came along, and I just dropped out of pop culture. It's like, what is going on here? All of a sudden, everything I loved about pop culture just reversed itself. It went from, you had to be highly skilled super entertaining to having no skill whatsoever, and all of a sudden everybody's creative. This belief that everybody is creative is what led to executives today running everything. People who have absolutely no ability in anything are all of a sudden telling actual creative people what to do. That all you can trace that right back to the damn hippies.
Oh, really?
Oh, God, yeah.
I never made that causal connection.
When I went through my hippie phase, had long hair and stuff for a while, but I never really felt it. There was some good music, and then that all went to hell. Like, the music all went to hell in the 1970s. I just couldn't believe it.
Oh yeah,
From really great hippie music like Jimi Hendrix and Electric Ladyland and Sgt. Pepper's Lonely Hearts Club Band and Frank Zappa, all this great stuff. Yeah. All of a sudden, it turned into hell and ready. All this weird laid back.
and the Carpenters.
Neil Diamond.
Yeah, yeah. Then it went
somewhere
else.
What's going on? Now it's like any idiot can write a song. People with no voice, with, these meandering tunes and stuff. And I was so mad when I was a kid. I became a complete cynic. I went from being like the most upbeat, optimistic kid in the world. I went from being Stimpy to becoming Ren when I was 12.
Wow.
It happened within a year.
And it happened
when I watched culture just die.
Yeah, the whole pop culture died. Do you see any parallels happening nowadays with the kind of taming of pop culture in general? Or just comic book movies have gone from like hardcore edgy to like just making mainstream?
Well, I'm all for mainstream. Everything, all my influences are mainstream. People are always asking me like, man, you must have smoked a lot of weed when you were a kid, right, John? I'm like, not really. You must have read all the underground comics, right? No, not really. How'd you get through your weird ideas, huh? Bugs Bunny, Popeye, you know.
Yeah.
My parents watching my friends.
Tom and Jerry.
It's all mainstream to me.
Yeah, it is.
You know, I'm totally mainstream. It's just that the business of what's supposed to be mainstream has become weird, like Eastern mysticism, hippie thinking. Like all this market research and everything that people do, and focus testing, and like nobody can just do anything by instinct anymore.
That's
it has
true.
To go all through this crazy pseudoscience.
It has to be analyzed in a marketing matrix to see if the target audience is going to come to it before they'll even agree to look at the first, you know, proposal. You know,
and by that time they've spent 10 times what it would have cost to just make the damn thing and put it out there.
Exactly.
Or just hire people who are naturally entertaining.
Exactly.
Who don't have to go through all this weird pseudoscience to figure out what the audience likes.
So
that's what's great about, you know, what's happening with the internet. Mm-hmm. I mean, I thought all this was going to happen 12 years ago or 14 years ago when I first started doing the original goddamn George Liquor program on the web, right?
Yeah.
I thought this is it. Now we're finally getting direct access to the audience.
Mm-hmm.
Now we can cut out all the millions of middlemen and the executives and all the crazy distribution.
Yeah.
Everybody taking their cut and then watering down everything you do.
Mm-hmm.
And it's taken like 14 years.
It's taken a very long time.
We're sort of on the edge of maybe this is going to happen.
Yeah, well, the marketplace has been resisting it for so long, but they can't resist it anymore. Now, content is moving from cable providers giving you 600 channels of crap that you don't want to single subscriber content where you get video on demand and get only the shows and the things that you want as you want them.
Yeah.
So
that's great.
Finally, it's changing. Finally.
You're not paying the cable company anymore.
That's right.
To make something.
And that gets us right to our point. If people want to get brand new content from John Kricfalusi, they can be part of it right now and can engage you on the internet and be part of this new production that you're starting up, right?
Yes, sir, they can.
Yes, sir. And that leads us right to, hey, do we have the ability to put on our caption?
It's on there right now.
You guys can see the caption. Okay, see? Now, way up there in the upper right-hand corner, there's a lower third that's right below us. It actually says the address for the Kickstarter. Tell the audience where they can go and how they can be part of this new short that you're making.
Well, you go to Kickstarter.
Like, yeah, there you go.
You'll see a drawing of George Liquor at the kitchen table with some mystery cans on the table.
It's so funny.
I guess you just click that and it takes you to the page. And then there's a video of me pitching the story to you. So I don't really need to pitch it here because you can just see it on Kickstarter.
It's very funny, guys.
It's a story about my dad.
Very funny.
And me and the kids.
We turned it into cartoon form.
It's about the length of a Ren and Stimpy cartoon.
Okay.
But see, half of it's already drawn. We already drew all the key poses in pencil. We used the same system that we did on Ren and Stimpy. It was a department called layout, where we would do all the poses that had all the expressions and the weird poses and stuff. And that kind of, those are the poses that tell the story.
Right.
So we've already done all those in pencil the old way. I mean, I don't even use the pencil anymore.
Mm-hmm.
If I was to do a cartoon from scratch now, I would draw directly on the computer, because you can sort of do the inking, the final cleanup, at the same time you're animating. It's amazing.
Mm-hmm.
But we had planned this cartoon about 4 years ago, and we never got the funding to finish it. So then I saw what everybody was doing with crowdfunding. Nick Cross, you know, funded a couple of his cartoons.
Yeah.
I've seen a lot of, you know, talented people just do stuff directly with the audience. I said, I got to try this. You know?
Yeah. Absolutely.
We just finished that Stussy cartoon. And
cool.
I've been dying to get on Kickstarter and just give it a shot. And it took we were trying to figure out, like, what project? And then I remembered I had this Cans Without Labels. And most of the layouts are drawn by a genius, by Jim Smith,
mm-hmm.
who was one of the key guys on Ren and Stimpy. He drew all the manly stuff. So he's really good at George Liquor.
Yeah, very
He
fun.
Makes him really severe and... Yeah, you know, he's like a real character when Jim draws him. You're actually kind of frightened by him.
Yeah.
So then we're going to animate it. Like, if we get the if the audience supports and it looks like they are, we'll animate it and color it, and do this music and everything. And we're using the same kind of music we used in Ren and Stimpy.
So great.
It's basically an extension of the Ren and Stimpy show.
Yeah, it's great. It's like revisiting, you know, this jewel of our animation. I mean, I have a short list of American animators that I think have been so interesting and so influential, and you're definitely on that short list. I'm talking about Mr. Bakshi, Don Bluth, and of course you, John, and of course Tim Burton himself, who went on from being, you know, part of the Disney, you know, sketch department to creating his own very imaginative worlds. And I see so many interesting American animators who struggle in, you know, with their art, even though they get to really wide level of recognition and wide level of success, it's still always an interesting struggle just to get things off the ground. And why do you suppose that is? I mean, I find that so strange.
Because there's only five companies that own the
world.
There
you go. There you go. Because
five giant corporations.
Yeah, because and Viacom
corporations
owns
make,
them all.
They make a million different products, and there's nobody who cares about any of the products. You know, if you start your own business, like, you know, I started Spomco with three of my friends, and we started it so we could do the things that we liked and we understood and we were good at.
Mm-hmm.
So tried to build the company on that. But, you know, whoever's in charge of Viacom now or whoever's in charge of Warner Brothers, they have no idea what they own, what went into making it, you know, how to exploit it correctly.
Mm-hmm.
So they hire millions of non-entities. They hire, like, they have all these levels of middle management.
Mm-hmm. Exactly.
Each department with a ton of executives. And, you know, when you say the word executive, the average person probably thinks of some guy who went to school for 20 years to become a business executive. They think of a businessman. They're not businessmen. They're just like nobodies. They're somebody's cousin.
Yeah.
Or it's the or it's the cute secretary that, you know, got a little older. She's not as cute anymore. So we'll make her an executive.
Mm-hmm.
You know, put her in charge of the creative people. She doesn't know anything about creativity. She can't draw. She can't write. She can't juggle. She can't ride a unicycle. So she's all of a sudden telling, you know, the really talented people what to do and how to dumb everything down and make it not very interesting.
Exactly.
So it's impossible to get anything done.
Well, that's why this Kickstarter thing is the perfect tonic to that. It's the perfect reversal of that, where the artist, the producers, Spumco, without any other interference at a corporate level or anything else, you are free to do exactly what you want, and you're not beholden to anybody.
Well, we're beholden to the audience, and that's what it should be.
Just the audience.
You know, it's like a stand-up comedian
lives
or dies
because
of the audience, not because of his material. If he goes up there and he says a bunch of jokes that he and his friends thought were funny, but there's crickets in the audience, you know, he runs back and he changes it.
Yep.
So, you know, a live performer has direct, you know, input from the audience. They cheer or they boo. It's harder for animators and filmmakers because it takes a long time to make the stuff. Plus, you have it's so expensive to make a cartoon as opposed to doing a stand-up comedy routine, which you just do in real time. It's just you.
We have over 1,000 viewers right now.
We do, absolutely. And
live,
you.
And
what are they wearing?
Just imagine them all naked.
There's a couple with video on. But
there are. Hey, guys.
If Ren and Stimpy started now,
No. I don't know what happened there. He did something right, and I don't know how he did it. I don't know how he managed to retain all those rights. And Matt Groening, too.
And Mike Judge,
And Mike Judge. I mean, there's a handful of cartoonists that managed to hang on to their work. And probably each situation is a little different.
Do you think their ownership of the work has allowed it to stay on the air longer?
I don't know if that... I think keeping it fresh is probably what keeps it on the air longer.
It's the audience.
Yeah, I mean, it's the audience. I mean, think about it. Fox tried to cancel Family Guy how many times?
Yeah.
And the audience flipped out, right? What are you doing?
Yeah.
You know, because they were checking, I don't know what. They, you know, these networks have, like, all kinds of weird charts and pie charts and things that they look at. They never ask people, like, do you like this? You know? So they make these crazy mistakes, and then the audience freaks out. I heard that SpongeBob, a lot of my friends work on SpongeBob, which is, you know, a giant cash cow for Nickelodeon. It's one of the only shows they have that actually makes money. It supports all the other shows. And that's one of the last creator-driven shows that they have, where the cartoonists are actually in charge of it and do their own writing. But they tried to cancel that early on. And you know, then the kids wrote in and said, are you crazy? This is our favorite show and everything.
That's what they did to Invader Zim as well. That didn't last very long because they had episodes of that show which were too dark for our network. And the reason why I know this is because I knew one of the colorists who was coloring spaceships and backgrounds and things. And he would come home in the evening and we'd have a glass of wine and he would explain, oh, you know, the hell that we went through today. Why? Because we're making an animated episode about organ harvesting, you know? That was the sensibility of the storytelling on that particular show. It went pretty dark and it went pretty weird. But we've done dark and weird many times, and they should know by now that the audience eats it up, that the kids love it. And I don't understand why it's such a problem.
Do you think that the short format of Adult Swim and kind of what Cartoon Network has done with those like late night cartoons, which are like 10 to 15 minutes?
Yeah, they've championed a 15-minute programming now.
Has
Adult
that
Swim
moved the needle a little bit as far as what's considered successful animated shows now?
God, to tell you the truth, I couldn't tell.
Yeah.
I'm so out of what's going on in modern, I mean, I just don't watch modern TV. I watch UFC, and I watch the Turner Classic movies, and I watch nature shows, and that's about it.
That's great. Yeah. Well,
love it.
Well, I have no idea about modern. I'm still, like, this is what I've been saying for years, is that I love the past, and I crave the future, but I'm bored with now. Now is boring to me.
That's interesting.
Yeah.
Very interesting. So
I can't wait for something to be super creative and skilled again. And it's really hard to find that combination anymore. And yet, that used to be the norm.
Yeah.
You know, they had old television shows. The early television shows were super cheap, right? There was no production value whatsoever. You watch the Colgate Comedy Hour with Dean and Jerry, right? And it's the worst sets you've ever seen. It's a piece of canvas where they draw a room on the canvas. And it's always wobbling and stuff like that. Nobody cared. Because the talent was so great, you're watching the talent. It's like one camera just on the talent, and you're just rolling on the floor laughing because it's about talent back then.
Yeah.
Now it's about production value and marketing, and it's millions of dollars going into the things that really aren't important, and the talent is the last thing, especially talent with skill. I mean, the standards of everything from the just dropped in the late 60s. I don't know what happened.
How did Ren and Stimpy happen?
Well, it started with Ralph, to tell you the truth. It started with Ralph Bakshi. The whole time in the 80s when I was working on really crappy Saturday morning cartoons and stuff, and I worked for all the studios, for Hanna-Barbera, for Filmation, for Deke. Hated it all.
Beanie and Cecil.
Well, that was later.
That was later.
That was
okay.
Later. That was after Ralph.
Okay, after Ralph.
That was a stepping stone to Ren and Stimpy.
Okay.
But, you know, and I worked with, my friends were Bruce Timm and Jim Gomez and Eddie Fitzgerald and
Jim
Smith and Ken Boyer and all these really, really super talented cartoonists, right? Lynn Naylor, tons of them in the 80s, right? But none of us were allowed to do anything, and we sure as hell weren't allowed to create our own show. That was just unheard of in the 80s. It's like, what, a cartoonist make up his own cartoon? That's crazy. Who's ever heard of that? Well, how about Walt Disney? You know? How about Chuck Jones?
Yeah.
You know, but nobody remembered any of that stuff in the business. I mean, all the cartoonists knew the history, but nobody at Filmation knew about it. Bill and Joe knew about it at Hanna-Barbera because they did it. You know, but they had let it all slide into this executive world of stupidity. And they knew it was stupid. They told me and other people, oh, yeah, these executives are, you know, couldn't hold a pencil.
Are running everything.
Their life
now
depended on it. You know, just some. Joe used to say some housewife, you know, that blew the producer. Stuff like that. But then he'd go and sell them all these horrible shows and stuff.
And they'd buy them.
Well, he knew. He just knew how to
sell.
Yeah, he knew how to. He was a great salesman, right? He was a very funny guy and a great artist too. And he could have sold them better stuff, but they didn't want good stuff. They want crap.
Mm-hmm.
So, anyways, that was the environment I was in, doing all this crap, right? But with all these other talented people. But none of us had any, you know, talent by itself is not enough. You also have to have experience and skill. And you don't get that without actually working on something and learning from the ground floor up. Like in the old days, everything was the apprentice system, right? You didn't go to school to become good at something.
Right.
You started as an apprentice for somebody who was really good at something, a professional who was great. And you learned from the professional. And as you got a little bit better, then he'd give you better jobs. So like, take Looney Tunes, for example, in the 1930s. founded by Harmonizing, who started with Walt Disney in Kansas City, and they started their own company, and they hired a handful of, they took some of Walt Disney's guys, Frizz Freleng, Maxwell, and a couple other guys, but then they had to find new people, right? Mm-hmm. One of the first new people to get on the staff was Bob Clampett.
Oh, yeah.
16 years old. When, you know, you didn't have to go to college to learn animation. You go to college and you spend 4 years in something called an animation course, you never learn to animate. You know, you don't even learn to draw. I mean, I hire people out of college and I have to retrain them because they didn't learn like even the simplest basics of how to draw something that you can turn around in three dimensions. But in 1930, here's Bob Clampett, shows up at 16 years old. First job they give him is a cleanup artist, right? Mm-hmm. So the animator does rough drawings and he gives them to Bob, and Bob cleans them up, and then the animator says, no, you got to do it like this, you know, you got the eye wrong, and when you turn it around, you got to be more careful. So they learn a little bit at a time. He gets good at that. Well, then they start giving him some in-betweens to do.
Uh-huh.
You know, and then after that, then you start getting breakdowns. So you're working your way up to becoming an animator. The more you learn about it,
mm-hmm.
the better you're going to be. So then he became an animator. You know, probably by the time he was 18 or something, he was an animator already. Same thing for Chuck Jones and a ton of the old animators. They usually started as a cleanup or an assistant, and they worked their way to animator. And then if they happen to have good story ability, they might become a director. If you're a good animator and a good story guy, then you become a director. Or maybe you're an animator that's mediocre animator, but you're really funny or you're good at story. Well, then they put you in the storyboard department.
Right.
So everybody working in an animation studio knows how to animate. Everybody. You know, at Walt Disney Studios, they didn't have any writers or anything. They had storyboard artists, and all the storyboard artists at least had some experience in betweening, and a lot of them would have had experience animating or doing layout or something. So in other words, everybody knows what the medium is capable of.
Yeah.
They know how it works, what it can do. So then when they perform their specialty job, they do that with all the other artists in mind. Mm-hmm. Like, I'm not going to design something that the poor animator is going to trip up the poor animator,
right,
and give him headaches.
Yeah.
And design something that works. It makes it easy for him. It looks good, but it's also going to work. We didn't have any of that in the 80s. Mm-hmm. I mean, man, this story is going on for too long.
No, it's great. It's a wonderful story. No. This is exactly the what we wanted to discover. You find yourself working in an environment that is naturally by itself not supportive of what you're trying to do.
Completely unsupportive.
That irony is like something I can't get over. But all of us who work in the creative field, whether you do voiceover work or whether you host a webcast or whether you're an animator or a director, most of us are trying to fulfill a creative vision working with other, you know, other people's money and other resources. And it's just such a bizarre balancing act. Sometimes I'm really, really impressed with what you have created. And I'm looking very much forward to what you're yet to create. This upcoming short film, Cans Without Labels, the Kickstarter lasts for another 2 months? 61 days?
Oh, no. It's like, no? It's 16 or 15 days left.
16 or 15 days left.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And
it's about halfway.
Yeah. And more
it's
than...
Yeah.
It's halfway funded.
But people who decide to get on this Kickstarter, and they can take part in different levels of sponsorship, right? And they can receive really cool memorabilia and sketches from Spunko. Toys.
Original artwork.
A really cool original artwork.
Really good, really great background paintings. You know, nobody does real background paintings anymore.
Uh-huh.
They all do digital paintings now.
That's right.
Including us. I mean, you just...
Yeah.
You can't find any... It's not... You can't afford it anymore. And everybody's losing the skill of painting real backgrounds. Well, I've got a garage full of these absolutely gorgeous background paintings from the Bjork video, from Ren and Stimpy.
Fantastic.
So that's one of the prizes.
I mean, fantastic.
Boo Boo Runs Wild, I got these great backgrounds painted by Richard Ziegler Martin.
Mm-hmm.
Amazing backgrounds. Like long pans of the Jellystone Park. Huge, beautiful things.
Those are fantastic. And you know, those are the things that end up at you know, in Long Beach at some animation gallery, framed and ridiculously overpriced, you know, 800% more than it really should be sold for.
Well, it's because nobody makes them anymore, so it's, you know, they're dying out. You have to get whatever is still left, because nobody uses
how do we reverse
real paintings.
That?
Well, first we've got to get the cartoonists back in control again, We have, and it has to get to the point where they retain their own properties. This is a big problem. You know, I had was I had to sell out Ren and Stimpy to Nickelodeon, and so they made $1 billion off of it within a couple of years, and I made zip. Right, I got a salary. Had I had a percentage of that, I would have been able to make a lot more shows, and I would have been able to make a lot more toys and things like that, and we could have supported ourselves, and by now, Spumco would be a big company doing tons and tons of cartoons, and we would have evolved. If you look at, there's another thing that doesn't happen much in cartoons anymore.
Yeah.
If you look at the old cartoons, you can just tell the difference between 1930 and 1940. That 10-year period, you can't even believe the progress that the artists made, just left to their own devices. They created the business, they developed it, and they evolved like mad because nobody was stopping them from evolving. Nowadays, the whole system is geared to where you have to have all your ideas up front, then get them watered down, and then once they're agreed and signed off by everybody, you can't change them for the next 20 years. So even if your show's on for 20 years, it looks exactly the same. We use model sheets now where, you know, there's like three or four poses of a character and maybe three or four expressions, and that's it. You can never make up a new expression. You can never draw the character better than how you first designed it. Whereas you watch Mickey Mouse change from Steamboat Willie to Sorcerer's Apprentice.
Oh, yeah.
You know, Bugs Bunny changed like crazy for 20 years. Daffy Duck changed. I mean, you know, creative people get new ideas all the time. They get better at stuff. It's crazy to stop them. Like, don't get better. So, and that's what we have now. That's the system we have.
That's exactly what the problem is.
Is that why all these second series from, like, you know, Mike Judge's King of the Hill, Futurama, all these, like, second series happen because those owners retained control, made some money, and, you know, were able to finance these other ideas that they kept going with?
Well, I couldn't tell you exactly how,
other
people's deals went or anything like that. I mean, you're talking about that there was a handful of creative guys that really... They did manage to somehow hang on to some properties and did really well.
Yeah.
And, you know, more power to them. But we need all the people to do that. We need everybody who has a good idea that people like
it's a proven
to be able to hang on to their properties so that, like, normally the cartoons themselves don't make any money. It costs more to make a cartoon than what you can pay the studio to produce it. So the way traditionally the cartoons made money was if you had characters that were iconic, that people really like the characters, they'd buy the toys and the comic books and the video games and all the licensing. And then you would take some of that money and you'd put it into making new cartoons. So I mean, if you can get that ability back into the creator's hands, that's the way to do it. Then we'd have another renaissance in animation.
They're so unwilling to negotiate contracts like that nowadays.
No, they just want to.
They just want to.
They want to own everything. They would rather own.
Yep.
Here's the thing: they'll buy something really crappy that they can own 100% of.
Yeah.
Then just split it 50-50 with you and get something really good. It's like against their principles. They'd rather own 100% of a turd.
Yeah.
Than 5% of Bugs Bunny.
Yeah, they have a chain of title that goes back zero.
It
steps.
May be a turd.
Yes.
But it's mine.
It's mine.
I own the whole thing.
Yeah.
That's how these corporations think.
We don't owe anybody else any other money.
So they'll make 100 turds before they get, before one SpongeBob sneaks through the cracks or something. You know, and it has to pay for all the dumb failures and the stinky turds that they made.
It's a crazy system.
It's not efficient.
It's part of the controversy about Disney producing all of these Winnie the Pooh movies and spitting one out every year when they're trying to assume control of the Winnie the Pooh character, which is really owned by A.A. Milne, the original author, and the author's estate. But Disney is trying to assert ownership of the character because of the commercialized properties of the films and take away the actual legal rights of the Pooh.
This is completely wrong. There should be a law to protect people who create things.
Yeah, I agree with you.
You shouldn't be able to sell
1,000%
your intellectual property. You should be able to license it. You know,
exactly.
If a corporation wants to pay you something to put it on the air for 10 years or something, great. Well, they can have a huge cut for that. But they shouldn't be able to screw you out of the success that you created.
And you own George Licker.
Yeah.
Excellent.
Well, I had to fight to get him back.
Yes?
Yeah.
Okay. So, and therefore, again, guys, we want to bring your attention to John Kay's Kickstarter page for this really funny and really awesome new opportunity to have the grand nostalgia of Ren and Stimpy back in front of your face. It's going to be on the internet first. Is it going to be premiered there where...
Well, you know, everybody that contributes to it will get their own copy of it.
Perfect.
There's all, you know, I've been having meetings with all these internet networks and stuff.
Yeah.
And so, you know, it'll be that, or it'll be some TV network or something.
That's great.
You know, somebody will air it. And I think I'll do a slightly different version so that you're not just watching the same exact thing again. So I'll have some kind of like funny Easter egg that you can only get in one of the media, and the other one you'll get a slightly different version, which I think is a good model to, you know, because to everything that appears on the internet, that's it. Everybody owns it all of a sudden. Mm-hmm. You can't, I mean, I have a whole bunch of cartoons, those old George Licker cartoons I did, the early internet stuff. I keep telling YouTube, take them down. I'll take them down. And then, you know, some kid puts it up the next day. You just can't control it.
That's true.
You know, so once you make something, if you own the characters and they're popular, then maybe you can make money selling toys and merchandise and stuff like that. Put that back into the cartoons. Mm-hmm. So it's up to you in the audience to create the future.
What do you think of the fan reaction? Like you just did a thing with Reddit yesterday.
That was a great thing you did with Reddit. And there were people coming up and asking you all kinds of funny things like, is this background real? And you said, yep, that's a real BG from Ren and Stimpy. You were helping people identify art and you were talking about your influences. And it was a very long, 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 long conversation.
It's like 7.5 hours. My butt was completely
flat.
Oh,
my God, I know.
That was marathon.
That is one of the best threads they've had. That was huge. If you guys haven't seen it, I'm sure that you can find it.
Do you do any conventions and stuff like that where you get to interact with?
Yeah, I just came back from Taffy in Toronto, TAAFI. And I was on a panel with Nick Cross and Marlo Meekins, a character design panel, and I did a keynote speech. And one of the things I do when I go to festivals is I show not only my own cartoons, but I show all my influences. I show tons of not only old cartoons, but old, you know, film noir movies and musicals, and not the whole movie, but I'll take clips that have influenced me, and I talk about how you can apply this to cartoons and whatever. Just try to keep it interesting.
There's lots
of caricatures of the fans and stuff.
The fans bring the love to these conventions, don't they? I mean, you feel supported. You feel the good love from the fans, don't you?
When I'm lucky. No, they're always great.
Yeah?
Yeah.
That's good.
That's something that's unique about this time and age, is that not only fans can support you directly, but, going back to Tolkien, you know, there's a lot of fans that read The Lord of the Rings and things like that that never had the opportunity to, you know, even meet him, meet the author, anything like that, and we kind of experience it in our own thing. Whereas nowadays, you have conventions, you have the internet, you have Reddit, you have YouTube, where there's a connection not only with the content and your characters, but with you directly.
Yeah, it seems to me like you could have a lot less people involved in the creative process now. The audience, the creator, and maybe a third party, the sponsor. Like, I love old TV shows that were directly sponsored.
Yes.
Like the Jack Benny Show, brought to you by Lucky Strike Cigarettes.
Carnation.
Yeah. I mean, all the companies produced the shows. The networks didn't have any say in the early shows. It was Colgate Comedy Hour presents Dean and Jerry, right? Mm-hmm. And then Dean and Jerry themselves, with their writers, would come up with funny ads for toothpaste and for mouthwash and whatever, you know, deodorant, whatever Colgate made. And you would remember those commercials. You wouldn't fast forward through them, even if you could, because they were so entertaining. Yeah. You know, and that sold products like crazy. And that's, you know, we did this Stussy, maybe, I hope you'll link to it, but last year I designed some shirts for Stussy. They had a whole bunch of artist lines.
Cool.
In fact, we premiered one of them here. We had the Marvel...
Yeah,
Marvel Comics.
I remember that event.
Yeah, yeah. But then they asked me after that one to design 4 shirts myself, so I did it, and they asked me to animate a commercial for it. So I said, well, can I do a story in it too, so it's not just a commercial? And they, oh yeah, that'd be great. So I did a story about Bobby Bigelow, who's like a nerdy comic geek like us. Dreams he wants to be a comic book writer one day, and then and the bullies down the street, George Licker's nephews, are always picking on him because he's a nerd, right? Just real life type of story. But he becomes cool because he wears a t-shirt. So that was like directly sponsored as a throwback to the Jackie Gleason Show and the Jack Benny Show and Huckleberry Hound and Bugs Bunny. All those shows originally had their own sponsors and the characters did their own commercials, which I thought was great. So now with the internet, all these pieces are there. They just haven't been put together. Mm-hmm. Right. Like, the sponsors haven't figured out that they have this power now. They're still pouring tons of money into TV commercials that nobody watches. Everyone fast forwards through them, yet pumping tons and tons of money into them, hoping that, you know, if you make the, I don't know, I can't even watch the commercials. They're so torturous now.
Nobody wants to watch them.
Yeah, but they could do it easily now. Get a creator who has an audience that likes them and put your name in the title of the show, and then have the characters pitch the products in a funny way and give the audience rewards and stuff. You know, you could have links to the sponsor's website where you have more cartoons there. Reward the people. Don't, like, commercials tend to punish the audience.
Yes, they do.
Know, instead of rewarding them for putting up with them. And
there's several episodes of Ren Stimpy where you kind of worked in the infomercial type thing. And even though it wasn't a sponsor or anything, but there was...
Yeah, the origin of that was the same thing. When I first sold Ren and Stimpy to Nickelodeon, one of the first creative meetings I had was with Vanessa Coffey, who was the main executive on it. And I showed her a bunch of these old cartoons and shows that were sponsored, directly sponsored. Look, Huckleberry Hound is sponsored by Kellogg's. He eats Kellogg's cornflakes in the middle of the cartoon. So no kid's going to change the channel during the commercial, because anything Huckleberry Hound's going to do, they're going to do. Rocky and Bullwinkle are selling bubble baths of themselves. You know.
Is that where Powdered Toast Man came from?
That's where all those... Yes. Here's what happened. I said, can we do this? Why don't you go and get Kellogg's or Post or somebody or Mattel and have them sponsor the show and have us have Ren and Stimpy sell the products? And she told me, like, it's a great idea, but you're not allowed to do that anymore. There's some kind of crazy FCC regulations against it. I'm like, why is everybody against the audience? They're against
the... that online now.
Yeah, you could totally do it online. So what I said to her was, well, all right, well, if I can't have real products, can I just make some up? She said, oh, yeah, you can do that. And that's the origin of Log and Powdered Toast and Sugar Side Pops and all the fake commercials. I really wanted real commercials. But since I couldn't have them, I just made up products. And then the weird thing was, the kids would write it and go, where the hell do I get the Log? I went to Toys R Us. I couldn't find it. So all of a sudden, Mattel and Dakin starts calling Nickelodeon, quick, we want to make all these products. So it happened. It kind of happened anyways, but it happened backwards. You know, it could happen all at once now. If you could just get a sponsor to, like, you know, wait a minute, why am I wasting all this money on ad agencies when I could just work directly with the damn creator who already knows how to entertain the audience?
Yes.
And then all those three parts of the triangle are all happy. The whole world is happy. All the executives will just fade away and crumble into the dust, you know?
Two questions.
That's very funny.
Where did Log come from? And what's the obsession with meat?
Well, I always just thought logs were funny. My dad was really into wood, right? Loves wood. But my dad hates to see a tree that's still standing. Something unnatural about that. So he has a collection of chainsaws, right? And we used to, like, everybody in Canada has a summer home on a lake that we call a cottage. We always go to the cottage in the summer. Mm-hmm. Take the long weekends, and Dad and Mom will take a vacation for a week, and you go up to the cottage, and you live in the wilderness, and you live rugged, right? We didn't have a real plumbing. We didn't have a toilet. We didn't have we had an outhouse.
Oh, my.
We had a double-barreled outhouse. You could go in there with a friend and have a double dump. I guess that's the way the pioneers did it.
Living the dream.
Yeah, and we didn't have electricity. It was all gas lamps and everything, so your kids were always blowing themselves up. You learn the hard way. And you had to like, cut wood. You had to constantly chop wood to use the wood stove and put in the fireplace and everything. So my dad loved cutting trees down. He was a one-man environmental disaster. I mean, he would buy all these chainsaws. He would never buy a new one. He'll never buy anything new, right? It's always got to be a bargain. So he'd go to the lawn sales. He'd go to people's lawn sales, and he'd bargain the poor guy for his prized chainsaws. And he has like 100 chainsaws, and each one has a different destructive, purpose or something. Like, this one's for small branches. This one's to go through the trunk. This one's to go through hippies. And you could just hear him. He'd be up at 4 in the morning sawing down the forest with these chainsaws, right? We had enough wood, chopped wood, for 100 years. We had more buildings filled with wood, chopped wood, than we had a building to live in.
Really?
No, it was amazing.
Oh,
it was
my
like
gosh.
There was this, like, barracks, about 10 buildings filled with wood. But still, you had to chop more wood. It's like, there's not enough wood. Might run out. Might get cold. Chop some more wood.
That's so funny.
Oh, yeah. So George Legger is totally into chainsaws, too.
He is.
Oh, yeah.
I'm really looking forward to this, to seeing George Licker torturing his two boys with these mystery cans.
Well, you know, he doesn't just torture them on purpose.
Well, no.
He loves them.
He thinks it's a great idea.
He completely loves them.
Yeah,
and, you know,
yeah.
He thinks it's a good building experience. You know, it's good for you.
It's tough very love. Exciting. Well, we have how many live viewers right now, Mr. Justin? We have
873 live.
We have
just over 24,000.
Wow, it's a big 24,000 viewers in an hour, Mr.
Hi,
John
folks.
Kay. Hi, everybody. You guys, you are visiting with John Kricfalusi, or I should say...
Kricfalusi. My dad's going to beat you.
I am going to be
Same
forgiven.
Well, he's still kicking.
Can I absolve myself of this mistake? Mea culpa.
Well, because it was too hard to write out Kricfalusi and to explain to people how to pronounce it.
Yeah, see...
And, you know, when you had to do signings and stuff... If you had like 100 mm-hmm. people in line or something writing out Kricfalusi, I'd get carpal tunnel after the third drawing, right? So I just fuck it. Called John K.
John K.
Yeah, my dad gave me a licking after that.
John Kricfalusi.
Be proud of your goddamn name. It's a man's name. If you can't pronounce that, it means you're a real man. Build up your lip muscles.
Did your dad and Ralph Bakshi ever get to meet? Because they sound like great personalities together.
Oh,
this
yeah.
I want to hear. This
yeah.
I want to hear.
Yeah, my parents came to visit during Mighty Mouse, I think.
Oh, uh-oh.
And, you know, they'd heard all the stories about Ralph.
Uh-huh.
I told them all about Ralph every day. And you know, they thought, what a great... I mean, Ralph is the guy that's responsible for bringing back creator-driven cartoons.
Yes.
It would never have happened. Like, Nickelodeon would never have done Nicktoons had it not been for Ralph... selling Mighty Mouse to CBS,
mm-hmm.
hiring me as a supervising director,
mm-hmm.
and then letting me create a studio system that just completely overturned how everybody was making cartoons. I just went back to as close as I could get to the old director's unit system that existed in the 1930s. Through, you know, no writers that couldn't draw. Well, actually, we did end up with one, but we would rewrite everything he did. But Tom Minton was an artist who was very funny. He was a writer. Jim Reardon, mm-hmm. I think it was one of his first jobs, was writing Ren and Stimpy, Mighty Mouse cartoons. Eddie Fitzgerald, me, Kent Butterworth, we're all artists, we're all writing.
Mm-hmm.
And that had not happened in cartoons since early 60s. That had all disappeared, that cartoonists would write their own cartoons.
Yeah.
And we threw out the whole assembly line system,
yeah,
and reinstalled the unit system. So we had three directors on staff, and each director had their own artists that worked for them. So the director would follow the cartoon right from the idea to the script to the storyboard to the layouts through the animation, the recording. We were directing, the artists were recording, were directing the voice sessions again, and that was unheard of in the 80s, completely unheard of.
Yeah,
like they have these weird people whose only job is to direct the voices. It makes no sense at all. And these people aren't artists. They're not directors of anything else. They're not writers or anything. They're not actors. They're literally like the secretary of a producer that got too old
exactly.
to fit under the desk anymore. So now they're directing voices. You know, and they direct them like an assembly line. They'll get 10 scripts in a day.
Mm-hmm.
Now, they didn't work on the cartoon or anything. They're seeing the script for the first time, and they're telling the actors what to do. It's an insane system. So we just overturned all of that overnight.
I'm really,
glad. Mighty Mouse.
I'm really glad that Bakshi's getting credit now. I think he's been greatly underrated for many, many years, except for by, you know, a few of us in the world of, you know, sci-fi fantasy geeks. We really know our artists. We pride ourselves on knowing our artists. But I'm so glad to hear you give Ralph that credit for helping push the industry in the direction it really needed to go. Because that has not been told. I don't think that story has really come out. And I'm really glad to hear you say that on the show today. But
can I say one more thing about Ralph?
I was going to ask about the moment when your dad met Ralph.
Okay.
That's the story we were on first.
All right. Well, we're working on Mighty Mouse, and my parents came to visit. There's all kinds of funny stories about this. But Ralph came over one night for dinner.
Oh,
and,
gosh.
You know, my dad and him hit it off instantly, because they're both real manly guys, right? They're very different in other ways. Like, Ralph's super creative and undisciplined, and my dad is completely disciplined. But because they're both tough guys and muscular and strong and stuff, you know, they're arm wrestling and shit like that. My dad, the first thing my dad did when he came to visit, he's looking at the walls, right? And there's cartoon pictures everywhere, and I've got my Fred Flintstone toys all over the place, and he's like, get rid of some of this shit. And he starts hammering a dartboard into the wall. Right? He rips the air conditioner down, puts a dartboard up there. Pounds the nails in with his fist. He grabs a fistful of darts and starts throwing them at it. It's like they're all bullseyes. He's trying to teach me to play darts, right? Put down that goddamn pencil. I'll show you what a real man does with his hands. So Ralph comes over one night, and my dad challenges him to a game of darts. My dad's an Ottawa champion at darts, right?
No way.
Oh, yeah. He's got a million awards and stuff. And he's all, like, now he's given up on the cans without labels.
Yeah.
Because now he wins meat at all the dart tournaments and stuff like that. He comes back with a million steaks and fish and everything. He wins meat, and he, you know, cooks me up steaks and fish every time I go to visit. All that he won with his darts.
That's great.
So, plus, okay, the dart games that he plays are really complicated. It's like you have to do a lot of calculating in your head. Uh-huh. It's not just do 1, 2, 3, 4 and work your way around the board. I can't even explain how complicated it is. There's a million rules. The more rules something has, the more my dad's into it. He loves memorizing rules. It takes discipline to remember 100 arbitrary rules. Right? Well, Ralph hates rules, right? He's like me. He hates the rules. He likes to make up his own rules on the spot, like I do. Yeah. Like most creative people do. So my dad challenges Ralph to a dart game, right? And so he's explaining all these complicated rules to Ralph, right? And Ralph's eyes are rolling in his head and everything.
Oh,
he's getting
no.
dizzy. He's like, fucking just tell me where to aim the goddamn thing. So my dad says, all right, well, the first one you got to aim at is 20. So, and Ralph takes a dart in his giant mitts, right? And the dart just looks like this tiny little sliver in his mitt. And he just goes, boom! And the thing goes right through the dartboard, boom! Through the 20. My dad's shocked, right? And what the fuck do I do now? Now you do 19. And, oh, and not only do you do the 19, like the dartboard, okay, it's wrong. Get a better pen or something.
Oh.
Okay. So, you know, you got your bullseye here, and then you got all your numbers going around. So this would be the 20. This is like whatever, 18. They're not in order or anything.
Yeah.
So it's kind of weird.
Uh-huh.
So here's, I don't know if you can see that. There's the dartboard. Here's the bullseye in the middle. And, okay, it's easier, if you're aiming at the 20, it's easier to get it in this triangle, this pie shape here. But if you get it in the edge, like this, there's an edge, an inner ring. This is called a triple.
Uh-huh.
So if you aim it, it's much harder to get because it's so small, right? It's still the 20.
Mm-hmm.
It's still the 20.
It's worth a triple 20.
This inner ring here is called a triple. So this difficult game, you have to get it in the triple first or something like that. Really hard to do, right?
Cricket.
It's tiny. Ralph had perfect aim. No matter what he aimed at, it went right to the board with, like, nuclear force. You couldn't believe it. My dad was
really?
Shocked, right?
Really?
It's like, and my dad was doing all the math for Ralph, right? He was writing, you know, doing all the subtraction. You work your way from 500 to zero or something like this, and you subtract each score that you get. Well, Ralph was getting a perfect score all the way down, but he couldn't calculate it, so my dad had to do it for him on a chalkboard, right? So they go through the one game, and Ralph beat him because he got every single thing that he aimed at. So my dad's like, fuck this. Now you got to do your own math, son of a bitch. And then he beat him. But they were pals. I mean, you know, and they're all laughing about how wimpy all the cartoonists were and how skinny we were and everything, you know. And they're like flipping our arms around and stuff. Like, where the hell is a muscle in here, for Christ's sake? Look at these goddamn wimps today. They had real men in our time. So,
that's,
yeah, they hit
so
it off great.
Funny.
Yeah.
That's hysterical. We tried to get Ralph Bakshi to come and talk to us about, you know, what's it like working on the Tolkien project, you know, bringing Lord of the Rings to life. And because we want to talk to him about his creative work, his creative process. And he's gone from these extremes, from Fritz the Cat to Street Fight, all the way to really beautiful pieces like American Pop, which is like on a whole different level, I think. And And in between all that, there's wizards and fire and ice and all this interesting stuff. And we figured out the wrong way to approach Bakshi was this obsequious, long email saying, Mr. Bakshi, with respect, we'd really like to, and blah, blah, blah. And we were all, he would have appreciated it much more if we had just called up and said, hey, bub, you know, let's talk. You know, that's isn't that much more his style?
You think? You want me to call him?
Yeah, no, hey, yes, that'd be wonderful.
I have a couple of girls in bikinis interview him.
Okay, that's the ticket.
With big butts. He likes the big butts.
Really?
Yeah.
He's a caboose man.
He's like Crumb.
Oh.
He likes the big legs.
He's
and
a
big
caboose
butts.
Man. That's awesome. Well, I
hope I don't get him in trouble with
No. But we would love to talk with Ralph sometime. But we realized that he stopped answering emails the nicer we got. The nicer we got and the more polished our emails were, then the less he answered.
Well, the trick is to get him out here because he lives in New Mexico now.
That's right.
So he doesn't come out that often. He does come out like once a year or something.
He just did WonderCon down in Anaheim earlier
this
year.
Oh, yeah, you should have got him over then.
We should have.
Oh, you tried, huh?
We tried.
I think we're driving through New Mexico on the way to DragonCon.
Oh, yeah, on our way to DragonCon in Atlanta.
Why don't you send him this?
Yeah.
And you'll see what he's in for.
Yeah, I am so down. I can't wait. He terrifies me, and yet he's one of my favorite stars in the world of animation. And I'm really looking forward to interviewing him someday.
Can I say one more thing about Ralph?
Yes, sir, please. Yes, sir, please.
Ralph, you need to come back and open a studio because he's done so much for so many artists. He builds you into a real man. Everyone should have their first cartooning job working with Ralph because every other job after that is easier. And he molds you. And you learn like that cartooning is not just like being wimpy all day long. He gets you to put your feelings on the paper. And if you don't, if you're just imitating somebody else, it makes him real mad. So, I mean, he's just a character-forming guy. And whenever he had a studio, he forged tons of, I mean, just doing that Mighty Mouse thing. Bruce Timm, Jim Smith, me, Eddie Fitzgerald, Tom Minton, Jim
Reardon,
Andy Stanton got his first job. On Mighty Mouse, Jeff Pigeon, all those Pixar guys and everything.
Yeah.
You know, it's a trial by fire.
Yeah.
You have to perform when you're working with Ralph.
Bruce Timm is a legend in these halls because everybody knows what he's done for Justice League and Superman and Batman animated series over the years. That's fantastic. Mr. Bakshi, yeah. I never really knew that he was that interpersonally connected to so much great talent. This is a revelation to learn this. It's really very cool. Very cool. So, well, Mr. John K, thank you very much for being on our live show today. We're gonna sign off in a little while. Before we close the show completely, I think we'd like to talk to some of the fans a little bit about the third Hobbit film. The big news that came out yesterday. But I mean, if you've got places to be and things to do, I'm sure.
Oh.
Don't you?
Getting rid of me, are
no,
you?
Do you want to stay? Do you want to stay for a few more minutes?
You don't want me around to talk about The Hobbit.
Do you want to talk about hot dwarves and Hobbit movies and stuff? Yeah.
Maybe I'm not an expert on that.
Okay. We
thanks, everybody.
We have had the pleasure of John Kricfalusi here on our show today. You guys, this is Torn Tuesday. Stay tuned every week for more mischief. And next week, Justin, I'm afraid I will be in New Zealand. We're gonna say farewell to John for a minute. You guys check out that Kickstarter page. Don't miss out on your chance over the next 16 or 15 days, and be part of animation history once again. And then we'll talk about the new Hobbit film, and for just a few more minutes before we close the show. John, it's fantastic. Thank you.
Thanks a lot.
Thank you for your time, your storytelling.
Made me hoarse.
Oh, it's amazing. Please.
Okay.
That water is yours.
All right. Thanks a lot.
That is so great. What a great show!
It's fine.
That's okay. We have bobbing heads all the time through here. Are you thirsty? Fantastic, guys! There is a lot of hyperactivity, a lot of excited fans, and excuse me. Oh, that was a sneeze that almost happened, but it didn't. The news hit the airwaves. As early as July 14th, when we were interviewing Peter Jackson live at San Diego Comic-Con, and he was asked by one of the nice ladies from HitFlix, she said, Mr. Jackson, are you thinking about turning the Hobbit second film into a third film? And he said, oh, well, I don't know what that would look like, but we certainly do have a lot more story that we would like to go back and film, and it could be part of extended home video expanded edition, or it could be part of another film. Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely, I would like very much to do that. So Peter said quite a long time ago, and now all of a sudden it's brand new, and it's actually confirmed by the LA Times and Variety, the Hollywood Reporter, and everybody out there in the world has seen the press release. The real genuine announcement came from Warner Brothers and New Line Cinema. They're not messing around. They really are going to make a third film. And that means after they've got the sound stages are still built, the green screens are up, they have all these costumes and all these weapons and all these actors, all the crew, the cast and crew and the greens department, everybody happens to be assembled. They're all there. And Peter Jackson said, you know what, Warner Brothers, why don't we spend a little bit more money and let's just put the rest of this together and shoot more footage, and you can get more bang for your buck that way and have a whole third film that will come out of it.
We have 780 viewers, so keep going.
And they said yes. They said absolutely. They said, we'll do that, you know, for another $65 or $75 million of production costs. They're going to end up with a third Hobbit movie that will make them another billion in theatrical box office, not to mention all the revenue streams that come from home video. Impressive, don't you think?
I think so.
Very impressive. Chris, do you want to come on the show? Do you want to come on the show? Because we have 800 live viewers. Guys, this is Torn Tuesday. You are here at TheOneRing.net on our weekly live show. We have so many. There's Jenny, and I can finally see my monitor over there. There's Pete, and I can see, is that you, Zanaseb? Muriel, are you all there? All of our friends from around the world are logged in. Hi, guys. I've been talking with John Kricfalusi for the past hour. He's a powerhouse talent in North American animation. I hesitate to just say American, because he's not American. He's Canadian. But so I'll say North American. A groundbreaking talent in the world of animation, Mr. John Kricfalusi. He was just here talking with us about his new Kickstarter and a new project that he's getting off the ground, Cans Without Labels, featuring characters inspired by his dad, George Licker, who you know from Ren and Stimpy.
He was always
his dad. I love John Kay. He's my new favorite guy in the world of animation. I had no idea he was that much of a bundle of energy and great storytelling. He's really cool. Really, really cool.
Like, this guy can tell stories.
He can tell stories like nobody. He's fantastic. But no. For this past hour, we didn't talk too much about the third Hobbit film, and we really have to tell you that it's real. It was just a rumor as long as 2 weeks ago. Maybe 3 weeks ago, it was just a hint. And this is what I found out. Peter Jackson was trying to use San Diego Comic-Con as a launching pad to make the big announcement that he wanted to make a third Hobbit film. I heard from a very reliable source who shall remain secret behind the scenes. I heard that Comic-Con was supposed to be the big splashy event. And you know what? They didn't have all their I's dotted and all their T's crossed. They didn't have enough of an advancement in the deals they were working out. And that is why Warner Brothers did not allow that announcement to happen. So all Peter could do was tiptoe around it. He was being barraged by questions from the international media and from the press. I was one of those reporters standing there, you know, trying to talk to him and say, what's the deal? What are you doing? Going back to Middle Earth? And then we realized if he is going to go back and shoot any movie to augment The Hobbit, or to be a bridge film between, you know, The Hobbit and The Lord of the Rings, which has often been talked about, but never seems to be, you know, a fully, you know, fermented idea. Peter has only one more chance to go down to New Zealand and make this. It has to be now under the title of The Hobbit, rather under the auspices of The Hobbit, because the only licensed material that can be turned into an adapted screenplay or a film or radio broadcast, it's only The Lord of the Rings and The Hobbit. That's it. Only those stories. The Silmarillion and the unfinished tales and all this other stuff that you guys love so much from Tolkien, none of that was ever licensed. And I want you guys to get that clear, because there are postings every day, hundreds of them on our Facebook threads. When are they going to make the Silmarillion? Oh my God. Won't it be wonderful if we get to see some Beren and Luthien and the story of the Silmarils? And wouldn't it be great if I stopped picking my nose on my live show? Come on, guys. There is no Silmarillion. It can't happen. The rights were not sold. And the Tolkien estate is protecting those rights fiercely. They're really, really hyper protective of Tolkien's literary stuff.
He went on the record. Was it Christopher Tolkien? It is the surviving
son of Tolkien himself, Christopher.
He went on record 2 weeks ago during Comic-Con. He went on the record saying he didn't like the movie.
And he's done that many, many times.
And he's only seen Fellowship.
He's deeply offended. Christopher Tolkien has always been angry and upset at the gross commercialization of his father's art, and that's what he calls it. At the same time, ironically, he's cashing those dividends checks and going all the way to the bank. And then he lives in a big, beautiful, elegant French chateau down there in the south of France where all the rich people live.
Meanwhile,
he complains about the commercialization of his father's work.
Meanwhile, in the 1970s, Tolkien sold the animated rights to Lord of the Rings for pennies, for scrap, because he couldn't pay his bills. I mean, money, commerce, and art always go together. He shouldn't have any issues with that.
Despite the fact that he's got issues, the Silmarillion is not going to be part of Hobbit, the third movie. All the stories that you guys keep talking about, that everyone says, when are they going to do that? When are they ever going to do that? It won't happen. So that's the reason why Peter Jackson said, guys, it's now or never. If we're going to film more stories from the appendix in The Lord of the Rings, and more of the stories that Gandalf is hinting at in The Hobbit itself, you'll realize that Gandalf is dropping hints about adventures he's having far away down in Dol Guldur in the south of Mirkwood. But all of that happens off stage. Who can blame Peter and all the guys working at 3 Foot 7, the production company? Who can blame them for wanting to film this story and flesh it all out and make it come to life in grand style? They've got the people, the time, the equipment, they've got the production resources, they've got everything aligned, and it's now or never. It has to be under the auspices of The Hobbit, and that is how Peter convinced Warner Brothers we need to do this third film.
And here's my crazy conspiracy theory, and this has no basis in fact or knowledge. I know nothing. Cliff knows more than me. He's already been to New Zealand. He's going back again. There and back again. What do you know? But my crazy theory is that I will bet you that the movie contract with all of the actors of The Hobbit says 3 movies. I think that 3 movies was always in the works. I think that 3 movies was always planned.
I think that
the story structure...
Why would they have the marketing department and all those people develop this whole big campaign for two movies and then switch gears on
everybody?
I'll
tell you why in a second. I think the writers knew from the get-go, Philippa, Fran, Peter, I think they've known since they started writing the movie that they were going to plan on 3 movies. I think they've paced the story into 3 movies. I think all the actors are signed to 3 movies. I wouldn't be surprised if there's no renegotiations with any of the actors because they're probably already contracted. And here's what I think happened. I think Warner Brothers, who is producing The Hobbit, I think Warner Brothers are also the first studio that started this whole, let's split the book into two with Harry Potter and the final Harry Potter movie. There was a lot of fan backlash, like, how dare you split our Harry Potter movie into 2 movies? You cash cows? Why are you just milking this? But then both movies made over $1 billion, and you know, no one's complaining. And then they did it with Twilight. Why are you splitting Breaking Dawn Part 1 and 2? And then they both make, you know, $500 million.
You didn't think Tarantino had something to do with that, with Kill Bill?
I don't think so, because Kill Bill was always its own property, and it was always 2 stories.
But it was the first time in the modern movie marketplace that all of a sudden movies were out in 2 parts. And it was expected. Now, when was the last time another major film had come out in, it's got to be part one, and then come see the next one 6 months later?
Matrix. Bam. So there's nothing original about Quentin Tarantino, but that's a whole different discussion.
Okay.
The discussion here
that.
Is Warner Brothers is responsible for starting this trend of splitting one book into 2 movies, and And they knew the fan reaction with Harry Potter. In the end, it all worked out. Everybody was happy. The fans were happy. They got more Harry Potter than they anticipated, and everyone loved it. I think they kind of paced their marketing. They tested the waters. I think that they said, you know what? We're going to split the Hobbit book, which is this thick, into two movies. And everyone went, oh, how can you do that? Are you, Peter Jackson's just going to bastardize this. Oh, no, he's not. Actually, he did a pretty good job with the last one. So there was a lot of discussion, and we spent many, many episodes here, and we've spent many discussions talking about how are they going to split these books? It's such a short book. Well, he did it. He split the books, and so I think they were just kind of testing the waters, like, okay, let's say we're going to do two movies and see the fan backlash. If there is backlash, we'll keep it at two. But as the months went on, the progression, fans were like, you know what, we're eager to see more of this. Like, show us more. Okay, Toriel, weird. Okay, let's do it. Galadriel, yes. Let's keep, oh, Elijah's back. Okay, keep going. So they kept going, and then they finally said, you know what, all right, we're calling it right now, three movies. I think this was always planned.
Always a plan?
I think it wasn't always guaranteed, but I think it was always planned.
We'll never know.
But
we'll never really know.
That's my crazy.
That's an interesting theory, Justin. That's a very interesting theory.
Jeez.
I'll tell you what. if it was originally the plan to fool everyone, and then what did they tell to their investors? What did they tell to the people who dumped money into the foreign market distribution so that they could be, you know, I mean,
I think it's all,
what did they, oh, I, no, not I think two it's movies, it's going to be three now, surprise.
I think everyone's aware. I think it was the biggest kept secret everywhere, that, and
you
they
think?
Never officially announced it. I think they just said, we're going to do two, probably three. So all of you exhibitors, everything, just letting you know. So they would never confirm it, but I guarantee that all the contracts that are already in place,
you think,
with all the actors and all the everything, it's contracted for three movies. That's my crazy. I don't know. Maybe we can ask Richard Armitage next time we see him.
Are you excited to see a third film yourself?
I don't know. I haven't read The Hobbit, so I'm looking forward to three new movies.
So you don't even know.
I don't even know.
You don't even know. Well, and having not read The Hobbit, we have one audience member, this guy. We have one audience member who has not read The Hobbit. I know that the other 34,000 of you have read The Hobbit, I'm sure. It's been around for 75 years. But this guy, he wants to read
movies.
It after the movie's out.
I like movies more than I like books.
Okay, so you're going to read it after the movie comes out to get a comparison to
yep.
it?
Yep.
Yeah, okay.
Yep.
So we have a virgin set of eyes who can appreciate Peter's adaptation of The Hobbit all by itself on its own terms. But the rest of us are dealing with the burden of 75 years of knowledge of what that story is made of, how it starts, the foundations of the work, the psychological direction the characters go, and the resolution of their story arcs. We know everything about this story. We have grown up reading it. Many of these fans who are on this show, they've read it 12, 16, 20 times
they
in their lives.
They were read it.
I've read The
read
Hobbit more than 16 or 17 times in my life. Yeah. That's how people are familiar with The Hobbit. So, tell this audience, and we have a responsibility to them. We have to tell them. Tell this audience that Peter is not just going to make this Hobbit movie look and smell like The Hobbit. It's going to be part of The Lord of the Rings, as part of
it's
a
part of the
film
Lord, that's why I'm
story.
So excited. That's why I'm here doing this show, because I enjoyed The Lord of the Rings as fantastic movies up there with all the other classics of cinema, and I'm looking forward to him doing the prequels more than I was George Lucas doing his prequels. So I think he's going to do a good job. I think the fact that, you know, one little sentence on one page, five words that say, stone trolls throw rocks down
stone,
the mountain.
Stone giants, yeah.
Stone giants throw rocks down the mountain, turns into a five-minute sequence. How can you take five words and turn it into 5 minutes of action-packed movie
It may
movie
be more
making?
Than five. It may be 7 minutes. We may get
this
a long...
Has seen it. This guy's seen the footage.
I've seen a lot of the footage, and it's stunning. It's really amazing. But, yeah, Professor Tolkien has one throwaway line, and Peter Jackson will end up giving us an action sequence that may be 5 or 7 minutes long. This is the process of adaptation. Now, you know, there's a lot of people out there who want their Hobbit movie to be just like the book. It begins on page one, it ends on page 320-something, and then that's it. You close the pages, and within the front cover and the back cover, That is a self-contained story. That's what a lot of fans are saying they want to see. But I'm telling you guys now, you better check your head at the door, because it's not going to be that. It will be Peter Jackson's film. It will not be Tolkien's book. You will always have the chance to go back and read Tolkien's book. It will always be there. And the glory and the beauty of his language will always be unsullied. It will always be there for you. But you should expect that these Hobbit movies are going to go way outside of the paper boundaries of the front and back cover.
So, that, you know, that's all I have way to outside. Say. That's all I had to say about this. I don't know anything more other than my crazy conspiracy theory and the fact that we were the first ones not only to record it, to hear Peter Jackson say it with his own mouth, but you were there too because you were watching with us on TheOneRing.net live because we were streaming with this actual iPad.
You guys were watching streaming. It was with this device.
It was with this actual device that Peter Jackson told everybody live that, yes, Third Hobbit's on the table. So that's all I have to say. I'm going to let Cliff finish.
Well,
this
no. You keep talking because I'm going to
you got it. Okay.
I'm going to hit the restroom for a super fast second and then we'll come back and finish this. I'll punctuate this point. Let me tell you something. You guys are in for something, but it's not the same book that you read when you were a kid. But it's going to be
it's going to be like the movies.
Did you know that one of the dwarf actors who's playing one of the 13 dwarves has been emailing me telling me, "Don't worry, you're going to be thrilled with what work we're doing."
There you go.
I've heard it firsthand from some of the cast members that you guys have nothing to worry about. It will be just a glorious work of art, but it will be different.
I heard you're going to New Zealand with a dwarf.
I'm going to New Zealand in about 5 more days.
See, this guy, like, he gets all the breaks. I'll be here in Hollywood manning down the Torn Tuesday next week. Maybe Cliff can stream live from the set. Wouldn't that be something? I doubt that will happen. Some talented fan will piece together a purist, book-loyal Hobbit from the 3 films into a fan edit. When was the last time we saw a fan edit? Remember the Phantom edit? Who was the guy that did the Phantom edit? Does anyone remember? God, I used to know this guy. He lives in L.A. There's several fan edits around. You know, one of my favorite fan edits is Pearl Harbor without the love story. It's a fantastic film. Fantastic film. Pearl Harbor re-edited without the love story. It's 2 hours, and it's golden. What else we got in the chat room here? So we asked a lot of questions. I hope you guys enjoyed John Kay. I mean, it was great to get some of these stories with Ralph Bakshi that, you know, the elusive Ralph Bakshi that we've been trying to book for so long. And he is, you know, I can't wait for New Mexico. New Zealand, New Mexico, whatever. Let's see, Houghton Mifflin box set. 3 was always the plan. Makes no sense given how big budget movie making and marketing works. Actually, it makes perfect sense because movie accounting is as murky as Mirkwood.
movie accounting is something
you
ridiculous.
Still haven't, you still haven't made a profit on Ringers.
Ten years later. Where's my bag? Could you please... Hand me my leather. Yeah, that leather attaché that's back there.
Hey, let me ask you this about guys. Okay, everybody. Yeah, let me ask you this because we got 1,200 exactly. viewers. We got 36,000 total. We've been debating this. Now that we know that there's 3 Hobbit movies and this is going to go into 2014, should we do a sequel to Ringers? Should we do a sequel to this? We're trying to figure out if there's a story. If there's a story that we want to tell. There's a story. There's a documentary that I want to tell. I don't know if it's appropriate for the Ringers fan base, but would you guys watch a Ringer story? And if so, what would you like to see that we didn't cover in Ringers and all of our YouTube videos? What would you like to see in a Ringers 2? I mean, we're going around the world. You're going to New Zealand for your second time. You're going to go a third time in November for the premiere. We're going to batten down the hatches, and we're going to drive to Dragon Con again, probably. You know, we're doing all this stuff, the Oscar mm-hmm. parties. We've got friends.
We are indeed.
Ian McKellen has been on video saying he'll see us there because he's coming to our Oscar party.
There's a lot of coverage that we have provided at TheOneRing.net, but back in 2005, which was the year that Episode 3, Revenge of the Sith, came out, coincidentally. Yep. Ringer's Lord of the Fans was a little documentary film that we made. I created it and co-wrote it with my friend Carlene Cordova, who was our very capable director. And we found that everybody wanted to talk to the reporters from TheOneRing.net. And that was us.
They still do.
They all wanted to talk. Yeah, they still do.
When we were on the press line at Comic-Con interviewing Peter Jackson, the reporters were videoing us videoing Peter Jackson.
Because of the rapport we have with them. They were like, oh, hi, how you doing? And friendly and firsthand.
And of course, we're filming with iPads, and they've got Ikigamis and Panasonics.
Yeah, exactly.
So I want to put it to you guys. What would you want to see? What story haven't we told? Whether it was Trekkies or Ringers or the People versus George Lucas or Starwoids or Star Wait or Indie Fans, any of the number of documentaries that Cliff and I have been involved with, what would you like to see in Ringers 2? Email me, justin@theonering.net.
Or you can email me, quickbeam, QUICKBEAM, @theonering.net.
And you can see it on the our emails are right there on screen right now.
Yes, they are.
But it's... like, now that there's two movies going on, and we're here through 2014, I feel like there's a story to tell. The hype is real. I think Bakshi's going to come out of the, you know, start doing more stuff. I think other people are going to start doing more stuff. I think this is it. This is the time. The problem with making documentaries, and with any movie, is you just have to have a story to tell. You know, whether you're doing a YouTube video or a TV show, or kickstarting a video, like, you gotta have a good story. You're selling a good story, because you gotta sell it to get financing, as John Kay's doing with Kickstarter, which I've already put money in, and I think everybody else should.
Mm-hmm.
And then you gotta sell it to an audience after it's done, you know. And YouTube has kind of changed the game a little bit. I'm trying to figure what the story is, you know. And here it is. We are right in the middle of it. Here's the biggest breaking news of the first third of Ringers 2, if that happens. It's like he's turned it into three movies. Bam. It starts here. Like, this is like the opening scene. Like, the hype begins here.
The hype begins now. There's a third Hobbit film happening. Well, we just lost our connection to the server.
Uh-oh.
Oh.
Hit refresh. See, that's the amazing thing about... iPads and technology is that we don't need big cameras.
Oh, look, it's coming right back.
Miles
perfect.
Of tape and, you know, rewatching all the video stuff. It's like we're just recording 1080p with iPads.
Thanks, Jenny. Appreciate that.
You know?
Well, I'll tell you, guys, the story about Ringers, Lord of the Fans, was looking at the past. We went back in time, like a time capsule, to see how the world has responded to J.R.R. Tolkien and how these people have embraced his books and his themes and characters. And we found ourselves traveling the world. We went to three different continents, and we interviewed fans in the United Kingdom, in New Zealand, and all across North America and Canada and all over the place. And ultimately, we found out that people enjoy sharing these stories with their young ones. Parents like to read the stories to their children. People have strong memories and really strong family associations with picking up the book when they were very young. And everyone is attached to this story in their own way. And it keeps going on. Even 55 years later, 57 years later. And what is it now? The 75th anniversary of The Hobbit this year?
Jeez.
It's still being handed down generation by generation.
This week.
That's part of the story. But there's much more to it. There's much more going on. There's a lot of business. There's a lot of critical, you know, money at risk. There's investments. There's been lawsuits. There's been licensing deals. There have been lives and careers made and broken all around this, you know, adapting this story for film. And that may be another story to tell in its own way.
You know, people are saying, like, what more is there to tell with The Hobbit 3? Bilbo has little to do once Smaug is dead. He coughs up the Arkenstone, gets hit on the head, mourns, and goes home. You know what else Bilbo does? He raises Frodo to be a hero.
That's another thing. Yes, Art, I appreciate your point in our chat, and it's really good to have this interaction with you guys live in the show. But there is a lot more going on at the end of The Hobbit story that involves... Bilbo adopting young Frodo when his parents die. The stuff that's hinted at in the appendix But
at the hands of Gollum?
Yes. And well, no, that's crazy talk. You and that conspiracy theory has to die right now. You have to put that on the shelf, please. That's crazy talk. Now, look, you know,
exit
stage, that side, whatever side it is. Come on. The way that Balin, after surviving the quest for Erebor, and after the Battle of the Five Armies, he and some of his dwarven comrades decide to go to reclaim the Kingdom of Moria, and it doesn't go quite as planned. That's a lot of interesting stuff that could be told on film as if it were the ending of Bilbo's story, but the other threads of Middle-earth history are coming together, because after Bilbo's story is over, the threads are going to come back into Fellowship of the Ring, and I think that all these films will be of a piece, as I've said before. So it makes sense to me that they could explore and extrapolate so much out of it. I think it's really, really cool. Guess what we found out? There's a news story that they're registering a bunch of website names that may or may not be related to possible subtitles for the Hobbit film. And we also got word, and we reported on TheOneRing.net, on our main page, that Warner Brothers and New Line Cinema are registering titles. Subtitles that may or may not change for Hobbit Film 2, Hobbit Film 3. We don't yet know what those titles will be, but one of them is The Desolation of Smaug, the Dragon. That would be really interesting, wouldn't it? The first chapter, The Hobbit, An Unexpected Journey, and then maybe The Hobbit 2, The Desolation of Smaug. And that might deal with, you know, the creature and them trying to reclaim the kingdom from this horrifying beast. And then, at the end of it, part 3, There and Back Again. The Hobbit with its subtitle, There and Back Again. Could be that we won't see, possibly, this is just speculation, but it's possible we won't see the Battle of the Five Armies until the third film. That's something that you guys are all talking about right here. It is a very big deal. The third movie, it's possible. The third movie might be all done and finished with the attack of Smaug the Dragon, and maybe they've dealt with that. And that might be the bulk of the action sequences in the second film, is dealing with the dragon. How about in the third film, we have an even bigger set piece, the Battle of Five Armies. They might save that for the third film. So there's a lot of speculation. There's a lot of fans trying to figure out what editorial changes are they going to make at the end of Hobbit movie part 1. Where will they cut the story so that it will be a cliffhanger in between 1 and 2? We don't know that yet, but our speculation is that it will be shifted. It may be changed around. Originally, Entertainment Weekly had put out that big, big, big storybook mural. I know you guys had seen it because it shows these chapter-by-chapter images of everything that happens in The Hobbit, and it goes right up through, you know, Thorin and company in Bag End, and Bilbo and them leaving, to go to Rivendell, and after the trolls, and then there's, you know, you saw that. It was a big, big mural. Not only did Entertainment Weekly have that online, but Warner Brothers reproduced it at San Diego Comic-Con, and Hall H was dominated by these surround screens that showed the entire mural. And we believed that we could extrapolate the entire plot of the first film just from looking at that banner. And we could. We could figure out exactly when The Hobbit Part 1 was going to end. Now it might be different. Now that they're going to be shifting some pieces around, and the story might be changed, it might not be the same. I think that Hobbit Part 1 previously was going to end with the Barrels Out of Bond sequence. That chapter that's very familiar, where Bilbo helps the dwarves escape from the Elven King's prisons. But if that moves, we might not see that until the second film next year. We might not see it at all in this updated version of Part 1. So there's a lot of unanswered questions. We have so much unknown that we can't answer specifically, but we can make our best educated guesses. There's so much money at stake. The idea of having a third film also means that we get to bring more stories and more news to you for another year, more San Diego Comic-Con, another year of appearances at Dragon Con and other events around the world, and even better than that, another Oscar party. So we get to produce an Oscar party for the cast and crew and for all you fans to come and and visit us and take part in the OneRing.net events. So it's going to be another big banner year for us. What do you think, Chris?
I'm there.
Well, are you there?
Yeah.
Come around here and sit with me. Come around here. Let's kind of do a pod crash. We're going to do a pod crash the way that Chris Gore classically does a pod crash.
Oh.
I have... this is an actual drawing by John Kricfalusi.
Wow.
He was actually sketching.
Oh, cool.
He was sketching here and trying to explain...
Stimpy.
Yeah, there's Stimpy, and there's a dartboard. He was trying to show how darts work.
Nice.
And, like, I know how to play cricket. It's very fun. Come on in. Yeah, scooch
right.
in and introduce yourself. Ladies and gentlemen, a very, very talented comics artist who's currently working for DC. They're the big bad boys on the street, and I have to say I'm not...
Warner Brothers.
Yes, they are.
Don't they
exactly.
make Lord of the Rings?
Isn't that somehow connected?
Yeah, I guess
Please
it is.
Introduce yourself. Chris.
Oh, I better watch what I say. But
yes.
My name's Chris Northrup. I'm a comic book colorist, making my own graphic novel right now with Archaea Publishing.
That's fantastic.
And I teach here at Meltdown the inking and coloring class for comic books.
Northrup. Chris Northrup.
Like the airplanes.
Just like the airplanes.
Like the airplanes.
It's a pleasure to have you come on the show.
Thank you.
We have 1,300 live viewers right now. Chris Northrup has worked on such comic books and such titles as...
I've worked on Fraggle Rock.
Mm-hmm.
I've worked on some DC stuff, subcontracting with Justice League, and right now I got my own book. So that's the big thing.
That's fantastic.
Right,
the focus is your
it's
own.
Taking
stuff,
any freelancing that I've been doing has disappeared because of my own book, and I have.
That's fantastic.
And I teach at Meltdown.
And we are here at Meltdown Comics,
which I'll never give up. I love Meltdown.
We can't.
So.
You guys recognize behind us the most wonderful and most famous epicenter of all geekdom here in Hollywood. This is Meltdown Comics, right here on Sunset Boulevard. You guys come on down anytime. They have comedy shows. They have
theater.
The comics.
The Nerdist
universe.
Theater.
The Nerdist. The Nerdist
and
podcast
Meltdown
is recorded 10
yeah.
feet away, right here.
Right there. I can see it.
My friend Mr. Hardwick. He's an awesome guy, and he's very, very funny too. He was the moderator of the Hall H panel at San Diego Comic Con, where Peter Jackson and Sir Ian McKellen and Richard Armitage were all there with Andy Serkis. And you're an excited Tolkien fan too, aren't you?
Oh yeah, but I'm like your buddy over here. I'm all about the movies. I get it through the movies, but I understand
mm-hmm.
adaptation, and I understand. Like, I just saw the Spider-Man movie.
Yes.
And they changed a lot of things in that movie.
Mm-hmm.
But as its own content, it's excellent. You know, and it really represents what the character's about. And like, as an audience member, a viewer, and artist, like, that's what I look for when people adapt things.
Even
I
though
want them to keep the spirit.
Even though it doesn't bear the strongest resemblance to the source material,
right.
it's still a self-contained story.
Yeah.
And it works on its own.
Yeah.
Okay, fair enough.
That's
so,
how I feel.
So you can forgive a screenwriter that arduous task that they have of adapting something.
Yeah.
Yeah, well...
It ain't easy.
It's not easy
yeah.
at all, is it?
No.
So where is the line in the sand? How far do you draw that line and tell someone who is adapting The Lord of the Rings, you have to stop at this point, you can't change these characters, or it isn't The Lord of the Rings anymore? At what point does that happen? For me,
yeah.
it happened once
what
in
was it?
The actual Lord of the Rings trilogy. At least once. It actually happened twice.
But was it a good deviation?
It was not.
Was it needed for the
most,
movie to function?
Most of the deviations they made in
yeah.
adapting were brilliant. And I will give Philippa Boyens and Fran Walsh and Peter Jackson all the credit in the world. I'll give them lots of love and a lot of credit for the amazing accomplishment they did. However, some of the moments of character were distorted to a point that it was not the character that would have behaved that way from the book. For example, remember the part where Frodo gets persuaded by Gollum that mm-hmm. Sam is after the ring, and Sam gets sent home. And Frodo, right before he enters into Shelob's lair, he
yeah.
says, "You can't help me anymore. Go home." And Sam goes home.
He listens.
Or and then he
yeah.
and he and crying and weeping, he turns and leaves Frodo by himself. That would never happen. Sam would never leave Frodo by himself. Certainly not with such a threat of Gollum crawling all over him.
Right.
Sam would never have been sent home by Frodo, no matter how demented he was by the ring's influence.
Right.
And Sam would not have turned away and agreed
wouldn't,
to it.
Wouldn't that just
That's the only critical moment where I thought, that's not Tolkien.
But
that is not the characters that I know.
Didn't they do that just to show that he would listen to anything? He was that
mm-hmm.
loyal to Frodo that he would,
yep.
even if he asked him to leave, he would
mm-hmm.
leave. You know what I mean?
The other, yeah, and the reason they did it was because they needed to fulfill this triangulation between Gollum and Sam and Frodo.
Yeah.
And that story arc needed to reach a breaking point. the breaking point of that story arc
yeah.
made sense to me as a writer.
Yeah, yeah.
Gollum Gollum over, not overachieves, but Gollum successfully influences Frodo and corrupts Frodo just enough that Sam gets excluded from the triangle.
Yeah.
If one of the three corners of the triangle gets pushed out by the other two, that makes for an interesting dynamic story.
Yeah.
That makes sense to me
You're
as a writer.
Yeah,
yeah,
course,
but
yeah.
but it didn't happen in Tolkien. And the characters would never turn away from each other like that. But aside from that one moment, which they corrected, and it was corrected in grand style,
right.
who comes up at the last minute to rescue Frodo from that awful giant spider, Shelob? There's Sam, who would never truly turn his back on Frodo.
Yeah.
You know, it worked. It worked out in the end, right?
Hey, as
there
a
was
moviegoer,
a payoff. There was a payoff.
I'm cool. It was a payoff, but
okay,
I can understand.
There was a payoff.
I can understand the deviation, though.
Well, I'm just saying.
Yeah.
All right. Now, let's look at what the difference is between The Lord of the Rings and The Hobbit. On one end, Lord of the Rings, which is a 1,200-page mega novel, was cut and trimmed and you know, condensed so they could make it fit into films.
Yeah.
Now, on the other hand, The Hobbit is a short little 280-page book where they're expanding and expanding with more stuff from the appendices and Tolkien's manuscript
the
notes.
The greatest experiment in adaptation in the history of
this
cinema.
This is going to be very different.
In both directions.
So what do you think of that? It's an exercise of expansion instead of condensing.
Yeah.
What do you think?
Are Lord of the Rings fans really angry about a lot of the stuff that got left out from the books from Lord of the Rings?
Oh, yeah. They complain all the time.
They have lists of, like, stuff.
Oh,
sure,
yeah. They complain. Why did you cut out Tom Bombadil? Why did you cut out
like
the Scouring of the Shire?
Yeah.
Characters, events, and places that were cut from the books and never made it into the film. Now, this time, we have the reward of them not cutting stuff.
Right.
They get to add more into the film.
Yeah, but are there fans that are upset that were like, oh, maybe Lord of the Rings should have been 6 movies, you know?
Mm-hmm.
I'm sure that opinion exists, right?
Yeah, it does. It does. So what do you think, what are you most looking forward to seeing yourself? But before we close the show,
movies?
Yeah, out of the Hobbit movies, right. Before we close this down, tell me, Chris, because you're a visual artist, and you think visually, and you've achieved some fascinating success, and we'll talk about your graphic novel before we close.
Oh, okay.
But tell me, what are you most looking forward to seeing as we revisit Middle-earth?
Dragons. I'm interested in the dragon.
Totally.
I've been watching Lord of the Rings, waiting for a true blue dragon, because I didn't know a lot about Lord of the Rings.
Mm-hmm.
So every movie I went into, I was like, oh man, knights, you know, guys riding around on horses. Didn't see a dragon, not like a true dragon once.
Nope.
So I'm interested to see Peter Jackson do a dragon. I'm really, I really like King Kong. It's one of my favorite movies. And outside Lord of the Rings, but he's good at doing scenes that are really emotional and simple, like when King Kong is on the ice with the girl.
Yes.
And it's just playing
yes.
that music and you get it, and then the bomb goes off and he looks up at the skyscraper and you know, this is it. It's over. He's such a good visual storyteller.
He is.
That I want to see what he does with a dragon.
A lot of credit to Andy Serkis for the motion capture for King Kong.
He was on the train that I got on to go to Comic-Con.
Yeah, Andy?
First class, yeah.
Oh,
Andy. I saw him. I was
fantastic.
Man.
Yeah. He's great.
I nerded out a little
so
bit.
So now we have Benedict Cumberbatch doing some motion capture for Smaug.
Yeah.
And this dragon, Smaug, is hands down the greatest dragon in all of 20th century literature. The greatest one.
Yeah.
He's the smartest. He's the most egotistical. He's most twisted. He's
Heard
so twisted in his ego.
Yeah.
And this dragon can talk a sentence of silver words like you've never heard before.
Yeah.
He's going to be a great creation
on
screen. It's fantastic.
All the pieces. Just thinking about how they're
going
to fit together.
All right. So will you be disappointed if you have to wait to see the dragon in the third film and wait another year? Do you want to see it next year?
Yes.
Yeah, see, we don't want to wait. We don't want to wait. We want to see the dragon.
I don't want things to move around that I was expecting from trailers and hearsay and things that I've heard, you know? I don't want it to shift at all. I want my payoff.
Exactly.
I'll get it, though. I know I'll get it. I trust Peter Jackson. I think he's great.
Ladies and gentlemen, Chris Northrup, a very talented illustrator and graphic novelist. Tell us where we can find more about your graphic novel that you're going to be.
Okay.
Is there a website we can check out?
Yes, there is. There's a Facebook page for it.
Okay.
It's called Truth About Dragons.
All right.
You can go Facebook.com.
Truth About Dragons.
Facebook.com/Truth About Dragons. No the, just Truth About Dragons.
No article the. It's just Facebook.com/Truth About Dragons.
About Dragons.
We'll check it out.
Yeah.
And Chris Northrup here, our wonderful teacher at Comics University that they host right here at Meltdown Comics.
Yep.
Great to have you also.
Thanks.
Crash the show.
Thank you. I
anytime.
Love crashing things.
Yeah.
But not your server.
No, we anytime.
Don't want to do that.
You guys have been a fantastic audience. This has been an epic, really epic show with Ren and Stimpy creator John Kricfalusi, who did my favorite Bjork video ever. It's just so funny and crazy.
Which one was it?
It was I Miss You.
Oh,
but
wow.
It hasn't happened yet.
Yeah,
yeah. Cool. But when you watch that, you're like, oh gosh, look, there's, you know, Jimmy
nuts.
The Idiot
that was
Boy.
Really good, yeah.
Yeah, there's characters from Ren and Stimpy. I love Ren and Stimpy, and thank you to John Kay for being our special guest. Thank you to Mr. Northrup for doing a pod crash. That was very fun.
Pod crash.
You guys email Justin at TheOneRing.net or email me, QuickBeam, at TheOneRing.net and share any ideas that you would like to have about what we could put in Ringers, Lord of the Fans, Part 2, which could be a follow-up documentary that we make about your phenomenon and our love for Tolkien. And so, signing off, we say goodnight and goodbye to an unbelievable 44,000 viewers who came on our show today.
Wow.
It was genius. You guys are the best. And if Chris, if you could, let's go and show the little sketch of Stimpy. Could you put that up in front of the camera? John Kay drew this great sketch. Can you see that?
Oh, I think they can.
Nah, maybe. You might have to back up to get the light on it.
A little bit?
Yeah, tip it.
Tip it?
Oh, yeah. There you go. A little cool sketch that John Kricfalusi did for us. It's Stimpy. Now, thanks for being part of the show. My name is Cliff Broadway, and I'm signing off and sending you guys lots of love. And to all our American team, go for the gold in London 2012. Keep going, Phelps.
Yep.
Keep going, you guys. You're awesome. And to our Olympians, we say farewell and good night.